Here's the story of how one man robbed the Bellagio and how he just wanted to get caught. The heist. The time was around 4 in the morning on an early Tuesday morning. It's the middle of December in 2010. Even for Vegas at this hour during December isn't a busy time. Anthony Carlillo had just ridden up to the Bellagio and parked his Suzuki motorcycle close to the valet stand. He backed his bike up next to a service path. He made sure to point the bike straight at the exit to Flamingo Road. Carlillo casually strolled into the Bellagio, but his heart was pounding hard. He wore dark overalls with gloves. He still has his motorcycle helmet on with the visor down. Inside his left pocket was a gun. He actually waved to a security guard walking around on duty. She was completely oblivious to what was about to happen. She even waved back at him. Carlillo quickly walked towards the high-limit craps table, one of the only tables open at that time. Quickly, he yelled, "Move, move!" The players and the dealers were surprised and jumped away from the table when they saw his gun. There were millions of dollars in chips on the table, and Carlillo began to grab all the chips he could. He shoveled handful after handful of chips into his backpack for roughly 15 seconds. But Carlillo would confess later that it felt like 15 years. Anthony Carlillo had just robbed the Bellagio for roughly $1.5 million in chips in less than 3 minutes. How did it get to this point? For Tony Carlillo, it all began with something he saw with his own eyes when he was in his early 20s. He was in Vegas in a casino and he was watching a man gamble. That gambler was betting on hard eight at a craps table. That's a bet he would roll a pair of fours before rolling a seven or any other combination of eight. It's a bet with 10-1 odds of it happening. But he hit that first bet with only a $5 chip. Then he let the winnings ride and hit it again. And then he let it ride again on the same bet and hit again. On and on, the man rolled and somehow avoided crapping out. To hit hard eight once was improbable. To hit it four times in a row is almost a once-in-a-lifetime event. The man cashed out $50,000 off of just a single $5 chip. What he saw with his own eyes is what inspired Tony. He had a belief that as long as you have the guts to let the universe dictate your fate, there's no telling what might come your way. Well, in his case, that was definitely true. Anthony Carlillo's first heist was not the Bellagio robbery. Just 5 days earlier, he had done his first heist at the Suncoast Casino. He held up the Suncoast Poker Room for a little bit over $19,000 in cash in pretty much the same way as he did the Bellagio. Why the Suncoast Poker Room? It was because he was a new regular in the poker games there. The problem was that he was a losing player, and he couldn't afford playing in the games anymore because of how much he had lost playing poker. Gambling wasn't what Carlillo was good at. In fact, he knew he was not good at poker, but he was determined to change his luck. So he did the next best thing in his mind, and that was to rob the poker game. Carlillo went to Las Vegas with a dream of a new life. He had previously tried to make his mark in rental real estate back in Colorado in the mid-2000s, but then the financial crisis hit and he was underwater on all his mortgages. He was in foreclosure for 4 different properties. He had listed assets of roughly $212,000, but he had liabilities of more than $356,000. So in May 2009, he filed for bankruptcy and looked for a new life out west. This was his way of letting the universe dictate his fate. By gutting his underwater houses of anything valuable, he was able to leave his Colorado life behind with $30,000 cash. He had dreams of being a doctor, so he registered for classes at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. He wanted to walk a straight and narrow path, kind of like his dad, Las Vegas Municipal Judge George Assad. You may be wondering, how come their last names are different? His parents had split up and he took on his stepfather's last name when he had moved out to Colorado. But that was a previous lifetime. Right now, Carlillo was looking to carve a new identity. The problem for Tony was that he was impatient. He wanted success too quickly, and he was way too distracted. He was able to only hold things together for 2 semesters at UNLV before the all-too-common Vegas party lifestyle took over. In late November of 2010 was when things started falling apart for Carlillo. This was during a 2-week Thanksgiving break from classes. Instead of his usual partying, he started gambling. He played poker and other table games at the Suncoast Casino that was close to his house. That was the decision that determined his fate in life. He quickly lost half of his savings gambling in just a few days. And being the impatient and impulsive person he was, he wanted to make his money back quickly. He took his last $12,000 to the Bellagio and entered a high-stakes poker game. The poker pros at the Bellagio were loving it. In a matter of hours, he lost the rest of his bankroll. He had no money left. No, this wasn't when he decided to go into crime just yet. He still had to hit rock bottom. After losing everything just the night before, Carlillo was able to scrape together $800 the very next morning by selling prescription medicine he had. And then he drove straight back to the Bellagio to gamble. But turning $800 into $30,000 is a pipe dream. He wasn't good at poker, and he certainly wasn't lucky in any other games. He quickly lost the rest of that money too. What Carlillo had wanted was right in front of him. On every blackjack and craps table were hundreds of thousands of dollars just sitting in the open. He started thinking how easy it is to just reach over and grab the chips. He still believed that he could turn his luck around. He still wanted to gamble, but he just didn't have money. At this point, he couldn't even afford to get into the low-stakes poker games at Suncoast. A few nights after his Bellagio gambling disaster, his fantasy of grabbing chips came true first at the Suncoast Casino. Because of how easy it was for him to rob the Suncoast poker room, he got the idea for holding up the Bellagio craps table. Doing his first heist made him realize how easy it was. All it took was literally a couple of minutes and a quick exit. The hardest part was actually just getting himself to do it. By robbing the Bellagio, Carlillo had achieved something he hadn't been able to do ever. He had made money all by himself, even if it was illegal. And he was now a millionaire. And this fed his ego, an ego that became his downfall. Now remember, he had only casino chips. If you guys don't know much about the way chips work, we'll give you the inside scoop. Not just anyone can cash high denomination chips. Anything below a $500 chip, sure, no problem. Even a $500 chip, sure, why not? But start having 1K and 5K chips, dealers are gonna remember who you are. And depending on the casino, they track different high denomination chips. Some casinos will track people getting chips as low as 1K. Carlillo would have to hand chips to Bellagio cashiers and hope they just give him cash. And obviously, he can't cash in $1.5 million in chips all at once. He would have to do it over and over again. But to be honest, it could be done. It's not easy, but it could be done if he had patience. All he needed to do was not attract attention to himself. So what exactly did he do? The exact opposite. Carlillo was back the very next day at the Bellagio, but to his surprise, no one recognized him. Nothing was different at the Bellagio. It was just like any other day at the casino. Except for Carlillo, he had a lot more money on him. He went ahead and sat down at a high-stakes poker game. He had a bunch of $100 bills from the earlier Suncoast robbery. To be honest, what Carlillo did actually wasn't that bad. Showing up at the casino to start washing his chips slowly is actually the right plan. Here's the thing though, you can't cash in chips without gambling. Maybe once or twice you can show up and people wouldn't think anything. But as we mentioned earlier, it's not possible to cash in all his chips at once. And if you're consistently cashing in chips, then you have to gamble, or else the employees are going to start catching on that something's not right. Playing high-stakes poker is actually the perfect ruse. All he has to do is buy in a few times using a combination of real cash and chips. During the time in Vegas, cash played on the table. Once he's done with his session, he can chip up, as a lot of poker players do, because carrying around a ton of chips is cumbersome. That way, he can slowly start washing the big chips. And oh yeah, this plan only works assuming he was at least a break-even poker player. Throughout the night, Carlillo slipped a few stolen $5,000 chips into his poker stack. The Bellagio doesn't bother to track who wins and who loses at poker. It's too complicated. Casinos only track who's been playing what game and at what table via a player's card. Carlillo probably knew that he had to use his player's card while gambling, because literally every single regular high-stakes gambler uses a player's card. That's because every player wants to earn comps at the casino. Because he's been playing poker, at the end of the night he had no trouble cashing out, even though the cashier asked to check his ID and player's card. The poker room was the safest place to launder his chips. But remember we said earlier that Carlillo had no patience? Even in the success of getting away with a robbery, he wanted everything too fast. It was only a couple of nights later before he began looking for bigger action. He found his way to the craps pits, to table number 5, the exact same table he had just robbed days earlier. Just why? Why would he do this? Was this his subconscious wanting to get caught? Was it about the money, or was it about the ego for him? At this point, the story of the biker bandit was all over the news. Carlillo was on local TV everywhere. Every local news station had already aired the surveillance tape of him robbing the Bellagio. People gambling were talking about him. And for Carlillo, it gave him a thrill because it gave him status. He admitted to himself in interviews that he liked listening to other people telling the stories. But it probably ate him alive that he couldn't tell everyone that it was him who actually did it. Everyone had their own theory on how smart the bandit actually was and what he would do after the robbery. Carlillo began gambling in the pits like a high roller. He was playing big, and he attracted attention. The staff of the Bellagio began noticing him, but they didn't think that he was the biker bandit or anything. They just wanted to make sure he kept on gambling big. Casinos keep high rollers playing by comping them. They'll give them sweets, free food, and tickets to shows just to keep them at the casino. Carlillo was assigned his own casino host, a usual tactic for anyone gambling a lot. They comped him expensive dinners and $600 a night suites, and he loved playing the role of the high roller. Carlillo couldn't tell anything was wrong, and he was living the life. None of the dealers, pit bosses, or security guards treated him any differently from the other gamblers, and he had a lot of chips that he could toss around in the Bellagio. He felt that he was in the clear, and he was, for now. Over the next several weeks, Carlillo blew thousands of dollars partying, but that wasn't his real problem. His biggest issue? It was gambling. He wouldn't be careful with the chips that he had. He never treated the chips as if they were real cash. All he wanted to do at that point was just play the part of being a big gambler. He was already living what he wanted in life, even if it was fake. The problem for Carlillo was that he had more than $1 million in cranberry chips, roughly $1.1 million. Cranberry chips were worth $25,000 a piece. These were only used by people who were the biggest of the big high rollers. Bellagio had every single person whom they had given cranberry chips before in a database. Needless to say, Carlillo was not on the list, so basically, his $1.1 million worth of chips were worthless. He really only had around $400,000 he could launder and use outside the casino. Carlillo should have been smart. He should have thought about his heist as a $400,000 heist and just threw away the cranberry chips. An almost $500,000 score is a big score for any thief, especially for someone that just got into it. He should have known that he would be giving up his life if he tried to cash in the cranberries. Anyone he tried to launder the chips through would immediately hold immense power over him. Although getting on the list of high rollers is possible, it's still extremely risky. He was at least smart enough to know that trying to cash a single cranberry chip would immediately raise suspicions. He should have been patient and played the part of high roller for much longer, but he acted with very little restraint. He didn't make the smart or safe play. For example, on New Year's Eve of that year, Carlillo flew an old friend named Alex up from Colorado for a visit. That night, Alex watched him bet $10,000 a hand on blackjack, and losing repeatedly. Alex tried to stop him, but Carlillo couldn't stop himself as he kept on chasing his losses. When the new year rang in, he was still firing off big bets. Eventually, he lost all the chips and money he had on him, over $100,000. That was just one example. Carlillo was losing money and losing it fast. It's only been a little over 2 weeks since he pulled off his heist. In the meantime, Las Vegas detectives Sam Smith and Jason Nelson were going through all their leads in their hunt, but they kept on hitting dead ends. They were getting plenty of leads, but none of them made sense, and none of them pointed towards Carlillo. Then the detectives met a man they call Leo. Leo was a poker dealer at the Bellagio. He said that he knew who the robber was. Leo was from Jersey, and apparently he reminded the detectives of the Joe Pesci character from the Lethal Weapon movies, and that's why they called him Leo. Leo said that in the days leading up to the robbery, he had spoken with a poker player who had lost his bankroll, and he had shared a fantasy he had of stealing casino chips. He didn't think anything of it. A week later, Leo saw the same poker player again, except this time, only now he seemed to have come into a lot of money. He was sitting in games he could have never been able to afford before. Leo started playing detective, and he began talking to other dealers. He talked to cashiers to confirm his suspicion that the poker player was buying in with chips and not cash. Leo told the detectives the man's name. After the heist, Carlillo barely left the Bellagio. The only times he would leave was to pick up stolen chips he had stashed around town or to unload cash into a safety deposit box at a bank. At one point, the box held more than $100,000 in cash. But after the New Year's Eve fiasco, he was down to his last $20,000 cash. Of the roughly $400,000 of easily convertible chips he had gotten from his heist, just a single 5K chip remained. He basically was back to his original point, except this time, he was a wanted man. Because he was strapped for cash, his fantasies took over again. He fantasized about cutting a deal with someone, such as famous poker pro Phil Ivey, someone the Bellagio could conceivably believe had access to a major bankroll. Carlillo wasn't the only one trying to solve the puzzle. Poker players on poker forums were discussing the Bellagio heist and what the robber could do with the stolen chips. He actually followed the discussions closely and even went as far as creating an account on forums. He was so naive and egotistical, he chose his screen name as Ocean Spray 25 and listed his location as Granada on the biggest poker forum in the world, 2plus2.com. One day, Matthew Brooks, a recreational player in Virginia, posted the hypothetical question, how many cranberries would you trade for a legit 5K chip? Carlillo began messaging Brooks with private messages. He asked Brooks if he would trade 4 5K chips for 3 cranberry chips. Brooks didn't know how seriously to take him. He was thinking that no one would actually be that dumb, right? In one of his messages, Carlillo gave him a number to call. So Brooks called him up out of sheer curiosity. During the call, Carlillo shared with him the exact details about the robbery. Just why? He could have just said he stole some chips off some high roller. Brooks asked for proof that he was indeed the Bellagio bandit. So Carlillo emailed Brooks a picture of 2 cranberry chips resting on a piece of paper signed Biker Bandits. If that's not wine to be caught, then we don't know what is. Detective Nelsons and Smith got their best lead from Leo. They learned that Carlillo held a Class M license to drive a motorcycle. They learned that he had declared bankruptcy a year before. They learned that all of a sudden he had started gambling for big, big money. It was just red flag after red flag after red flag. Nelson also turned up one more fact. They figured out that his dad was a sitting Las Vegas judge, George Assad. They knew that if they were not right, their careers were pretty much going to go nowhere. On January 13th, Las Vegas detectives put a trap and trace on Carlillo's cell phone to log all of his incoming and outgoing calls. A week later, they pulled all his player records. In the 4 years leading up to the robbery, Carlillo had lost a total of $2,900 at the casino. Since the robbery, he had lost $105,000. By that time, they knew that he was the bandit. But knowing and proving are two different things. Brooks still couldn't believe what he got from Carlillo. Obviously, he didn't have any 5K Bellagio chips. He came to realize that he was talking to the real Bellagio bandit. He forwarded the photo Carlillo gave him to the Bellagio and to the Las Vegas police. The IP address attached to the email revealed that it was sent from the house of Judge George Assad. A few days later, Carlillo was at the Venetian, playing in a $1,500 buy-in poker tournament. During the dinner break, a stranger came up and sat at his table. The man knew the poker dealer and made small talk, but he also began introducing himself to Carlillo. Kian Cava was a local doctor, and somewhere he had heard that Carlillo had $25,000 chips for sale. Carlillo made absolutely no connection between the doctor and what he had revealed to Brooks on email and over the phone. It wasn't too long before he agreed to meet with Dr. Cava and a connected guy from New Jersey named Dominic, who would be a buyer of cranberry chips. Dominic worked in the loan sharking business back east and was thinking of starting up a crew out in Las Vegas. Carlillo started off being very cautious and suspicious. When Dominic offered him $10,000 in cash right then and there for a cranberry chip, Carlillo actually wouldn't take it. Carlillo met with Dominic repeatedly over the next few days and gradually came to trust him. They played blackjack together and traded text messages about which college football games to bet on. Over expensive steak dinners and gambling together, they discussed the deal for cranberry chips. On January 30th, Dominic slid a wineless menu across the table to Carlillo over dinner. Inside the menu was $10,000 in cash and some smaller chips. Carlillo pocketed the money and passed a $25,000 chip back to Dominic. Carlillo would sell a total of $100,000 worth of cranberry chips over the course of the next 2 days. On February 2nd, they met one last time in a Bellagio bathroom. 6 Vegas police officers stormed through the bathroom door and yelled at Carlillo to get on the floor. The dream was over. Dominic was actually a Las Vegas police officer named Mike Gennaro. Dr. Cava was actually a real medical doctor. He was just a friend of Gennaro's and also a casual poker player who had agreed to help. The money and chips Gennaro used to gamble with and buy Carlillo's cranberries had been loaned to him by the Bellagio itself. Just 7 weeks after Carlillo's big heist, he was now in handcuffs and his dad was voted off the bench before his sentencing. He ended up getting between 9 and 27 years in prison for the Bellagio heist and the Suncoast robbery. The earliest he can get out is around the end of 2020. In another universe, he gambled at the Bellagio a little bit every day, like a lot of gamblers in Vegas do. He was smart and he realized that he didn't need to start off so big. That way, no one in his life had any suspicion. He never told anyone about the robbery, and he certainly didn't flaunt any big chips. He worked his way up in the poker room and moved through the stakes each year. And you know what? He actually became decent over time. To anyone in the poker room, he wasn't crushing the game, but he was good enough to move up the stakes each year. And a mid-stakes poker player making six figures a year in Las Vegas isn't anything unusual. Carlillo was just like any other poker player in Vegas. He was a consistent winner who liked to gamble a little bit of his poker winnings in the pits from time to time. He washed his chips from the heist at the Bellagio over a course of 5 years, and he even hit it big a few times at blackjack on the nights he had big wins at poker. And he was able to color up his chips to get on the cranberry list. And eventually, over time, he was just another high roller who had made his money through poker. But of course, this is Carlillo in another universe. Just exactly how did this guy scam almost $40 million from smart businessmen? Find out how he lured them right in. Everything for Castle Quo came to an end one early morning in November 2016. He had just flown in from Liberia to see his family in Charlotte, North Carolina. He was just getting his kids ready for school, just like any other morning. But there was a knock on the door. An agent from Homeland Security Investigations wanted to ask Quo some questions. Quo was initially unfriendly in his answers, but then the agent declared, "We have a warrant to arrest you." For anyone, seeing $100 million worth of gold right in front of you would be a once-in-a-lifetime experience. This is what one businessman from Atlanta who wanted to stay anonymous experienced. The gold was indeed real, but he unfortunately was going to be a part of one of the most convincing and sophisticated scams that has ever been witnessed by the US law enforcement. This scam was made possible by a lot of ingenuity and corrupt government officials in Africa. The unfortunate anonymous businessman described the whole ordeal. He described the setup for the whole scam scheme that was so convincing that anyone, even the smartest person, would easily fall for this scam. I mean, this is what all people who got scammed would say, right? Because if they got scammed, there would be no way that someone else wouldn't fall for it. The Atlanta businessman fell for this scam back in 2015. He had received a call from one of his friends who told him about a miner named Castle Quo from Liberia. Obviously, his friend had nothing but good things to say about Castle. Quo was described as a success story in Liberia. He was a philanthropist for the impoverished communities in Africa. And this is actually true. He was a founder of a soccer team. This was true too. The businessman was also told that Quo owned warehouses filled with diamonds and gold that were worth hundreds of millions of dollars. He was described as an up-and-coming Liberian businessman who could be trusted for big transactions. And his friend was seeing if he wanted to invest. According to public records and statements made in open court from June 2012 to December 2016, Quo orchestrated a fraudulent scheme involving the purchase, shipment, and export of unrefined gold and rough diamonds allegedly located in Liberia. Quo was a Liberian national who owned Phoenix Mining, an investment group, which was supposedly to be in the precious metal and gemstone business. Chris Healy is an assistant special agent in charge of Homeland Security Investigations in Charlotte. He was shocked at just how much money was involved. It wasn't just a million or two, or even 5 million. The amount was around $30 to $40 million. Obviously, the guy was already falling for this, but he wanted to make sure that Quo was the real deal. He did some background research on Quo and met him in New York City. He wanted to test some of his gold to make sure that it was real. And yep, the gold test passed with flying colors. But he even took it a step further. He wanted to go to Liberia to see the gold mines for himself. So Quo said, okay. While he was in Liberia, he visited the mining sites. He visited with the government officials of Liberia. He was also invited to Quo's home and met his family. He went to Quo's office where Quo showed him around 900 pounds of gold. There were sacks filled with gold and also nearly 24 gold bars next to the sacks. All this was real gold. Okay, maybe this guy was right. Maybe it is hard not to fall for this, because seeing was believing. The problem for this guy was that it was all smoke and mirrors. Quo had done the same kit and caboodle for many people over the years. Sometimes he would even bring gold and bulletproof vans guarded by our men. Why did this work? Because psychologically, no one would spend this much money and put in this much work just to run a scam, right? And who actually had access to hundreds of millions of dollars of gold, even if it's just to put on a show? People are made to travel thousands of miles to see the gold, and they were allowed to do even more testing on the gold in any way they like. But while these clients were mesmerized by the sheer amount of gold that's shown to them, they forgot to ask one crucial question. Who actually owned the gold? The trick was simple. Show that there was gold. Real gold, and lots of it. Once the clients were convinced, then the rest was on them. They just needed to help get the gold to the US. What the potential clients needed to do was pay for any costs that were required for the certifications and shipment of the gold. Then they would sell the gold and split the profit. Yep, this is how the money poured in. The Atlanta businessman wasn't the only person scammed. People from all over the world, including the UAE, South Africa, India, and Saudi Arabia, jumped in falling for this scam. Do you see where this is going yet? How did Quo get his hands on so much gold? He did have access to the gold, but that gold was not ever going to be moving anywhere. That's because the vast majority of the gold belonged to the government. All Quo did was bribe liberating government officials, and he could show the gold all day long. Of course, with any scammer, there's some semblance of the truth. He does have his own mine, but it didn't produce anywhere close to the amount of gold he said he had. Whenever clients wanted to see the gold, he would just bring in the amount of gold the client wanted to see. That amount of gold would be brought straight in from the government. Sometimes Quo would even make deals with government officials of other African countries and gold refinery operators in order to make these meetings happen. And these other government officials would happily comply. Why would they care if some poor sucker was getting scammed? Okay, so what would happen once Quo got the money? Well, after this, the game was delay, delay, and then do some more delays. Quo had set up a fake website where the clients could track their shipments, but like clockwork, the website was always updated with new unforeseen delays. New stories of why the gold was getting delayed would pop up. These clients were so thirsty for gold profits, Quo would even be able to convince clients to pay a little more to get the shipment to come. He would just tell the clients that the shipment would be canceled unless they paid more. Most of the time, he would say that the shipment was stuck at customs and it would take time. But the actual truth was, there was no package. Quo would just completely make up documents and keep on telling stories to keep the clients hooked to the process. It was a vicious cycle. In reality, Quo used investors' money to fund his personal lifestyle. The delays became a fact of life for the Atlanta businessman. In his mind, things getting delayed in customs was normal. He had no reason not to believe any of the delays, because he spoke with Quo nearly every day on the phone. The money he had invested wasn't only his own, but he also invested money from his close friends and relatives. All that only made Quo richer day by day. He was traveling around the world and living a life of luxury. He bought a house in Charlotte, North Carolina for his wife and kids. He was enjoying a life of luxury in the US. Quo thought for a long time that he wouldn't be caught. He was convinced that the Liberian government officials he bribed would be able to help him as they were also involved in this conspiracy. All the earlier stories we had told you about Quo actually were true. He had built up a Robin Hood-like image in his country. He was beloved by the impoverished Liberians for the things that he did for his community, something the Atlanta businessman witnessed himself. He donated a lot of money regularly to his church. He would feed a lot of people in the city. Quo helped to send several children in his community to school. He installed 24 hand pumps in his village for safe drinking water. And this was one of the first things that attracted the Atlanta businessman to Quo when he made that first trip to Liberia. Quo himself said that despite everything, he wanted to take care of his people. All in all, he spent a whopping $8 million on his community back in Liberia. Let's go back to that morning in November 2016. On that day, Quo was arrested by Homeland Security. The Atlanta businessman was completely shocked. He had no idea why anyone would arrest someone like Castle, even after he was arrested. And he wasn't the only one. Obviously, all of Quo's clients were convinced by the show that he had put up. They couldn't believe that he was capable of running such a scam. Not after giving so much away to his community. One client would not believe it at all, and Quo had to call him on the phone himself to tell him to stop sending money to his associates because it was a giant scam. Castle pleaded guilty to wire fraud conspiracy. He cooperated with authorities and hoped for a reduced sentence by telling his story. Surprisingly, he didn't refute any of his wrongdoings. Surprisingly, Quo actually said that getting arrested was the best thing that had happened to him. He was happy that he got caught because he was going down the wrong path. Interestingly enough, he did give a reason to why he did it. Apparently, it was him being part of a scammer syndicate that led him to commit the crime. According to Quo, he owed the syndicate a lot. Quo claimed to be filled with regret and confessed that he thought a lot about his victims, especially the Atlanta businessman, and he's happy that no one would be victimized by him anymore. Do you think he's still putting on a show here? The Liberian embassy was contacted after Quo's story to the authorities. They applauded the arrest of Quo and expressed deep concerns about corrupt officials who may be trying to exploit the gold and diamond industry. But, surprise, surprise, they denied any knowledge of any government officials being involved in the scam. So, did confessing to everything and showing remorse help? Nope. That was probably the real reason he was crying. Quo was sentenced to 17 years in prison and ordered to pay $16.2 million in restitution. Yeah, good luck getting that $16.2 million. How did this brother-sister pair scam over $4 billion from investors? OneCoin. OneCoin was a money heist that took billions from investors between 2014 and 2018. The brains behind this scheme was Ruja Ignatova. Although the US government previously estimated OneCoin's take at $4 billion, there are sources that claim the worldwide take was as much as $15.8 billion as of early 2018. What made OneCoin so attractive? It was its viral commission-driven structure that helped it be sold to many vulnerable, tech-naive communities such as working-class England and South Asia. Ruja Ignatova is a well-educated woman with a PhD in European private law. And it's a good thing she has a lot of lawyer friends because in 2012, she was convicted of fraud in Germany. She was actually sentenced to 14 years in prison, but her sentence was later suspended. So what did she decide to do? Create one of the biggest scams ever, because why not? Ruja, along with her lawyer, Sebastian Greenwood, created a Ponzi scheme that had the hottest thing going on for investors at the time, blockchain. They created OneCoin, a coin that they promised to rival Bitcoin. Bitcoin's rise in value from a few cents to hundreds of dollars per coin by mid-2016 had retail investors hungry for more ways to get rich quick. Crypto 101. In case you didn't know how crypto works, the only thing you have to understand is this. Quickly. Something is only valuable because other people think it's valuable, whether it's money, diamonds, or gold. It only works when other people put value on it and trust the value can hold. For a long time, people have tried to create digital money. But everything always failed because no one could trust them. They would always need someone in charge. With someone in charge, they could manipulate the supply, and there goes the concept. But Bitcoin solved that problem. It depends on a database called a blockchain. Basically, it's a giant digital book of every transaction that involves any Bitcoin. And everyone has a copy of it. Every time a Bitcoin is sent, a record of that transaction goes into everyone's book. Nobody could change it. So this means that Bitcoins couldn't be manipulated and could not be hacked. Bitcoin gave way for the potential to change how banking works. Bitcoin with its blockchain became a game changer. The pitch. What Ruja knew was that the average person wanted to get rich fast. And with Bitcoin's fast rise, she knew that she had something to see to the masses. The scam was predicated on enthusiasm and a quick sell. All of the talks geared around how the people were so lucky to be getting in at that stage. Ruja would pitch that one coin would be like Bitcoin. It's going to go bigger. Ruja would spin her background of a degree from Oxford, a PhD from Constanz, a stint with the respected management consultancy McKinsey. Who knows if all that was true? It probably wasn't. Her main thing was to take advantage of the fact that the average person she was pitching to just didn't understand what they were investing. What's a blockchain? Who knows? Does it even need to exist? No! Even if it did, what did it do for OneCoin? Who cares? The coin was going to the moon. Seriously, the thing is this. If you don't understand how a specific investment makes money, you should not invest in it. MLM recruits. Ruja would also specifically recruit experienced multi-level marketers. We'll go through a super quick rundown on how multi-level marketing works. Basically, let's say you're selling makeup. Whatever makeup you sell, of course, you keep 100% of the profits. But let's say if you bring in someone else into the business, then you get a percentage of their sales too. And whoever they bring in, you would get a cut too, and so on. This type of business is actually legal, but if you think about it, it basically operates as a pyramid scheme. Because only a small number of people make a lot of money, and it's the people at the bottom doing all the work. And Ruja would bring in these types of people on purpose. She recognized that established multi-level marketing sellers with a huge base had the perfect type of people to market her fake coin. This was the secret of OneCoin's success. It was an old-fashioned pyramid scheme masqueraded as a coin with a future. Company holdings. OneCoin's corporate structure was incredibly complicated. Obviously, it was on purpose. For example, Ruja bought a property in Central Sofia. Technically, it was owned by a company called One Property. One Property was owned by another company called Risk Limited. That company was owned by Ruja, but was then transferred to some unnamed Panamanians, but it was still managed by another company called Paragon. And Paragon was owned by another company called Artifix, which was owned by Ruja's mother, Vesca. And back in 2017, the ownership of Artifix was sold to an unknown man in his 20s. Is this needlessly complex? Yes, if you're running a legitimate business. But it's absolutely necessary if you're running one of the biggest scams the world has ever seen. OneCoin's business. This scam quickly became one of the biggest scams the world has ever seen. What exactly was the main business? Because really, just having a blockchain doesn't mean anything. OneCoin's main revenue was supposedly from selling educational materials for trading. Members were able to purchase educational materials for exorbitant prices ranging from 100 euros to 118,000 euros. Obviously, no one was buying any sort of educational packages. There was absolutely nothing that the company came out with to generate revenue. Their only way to get money was to pitch investing in the company. For every package that gets purchased, game tokens, which the buyers can use to mine coins. Basically, the more money you spent, the more tokens you got, which meant the more coins you could mine. And the only way of exchanging the mined OneCoins was through OneCoin's own exchange. In early June 2016, Ruja Ignatova walked on stage at Wembley Stadium in London in front of thousands of investors. She told the cheering crowd that OneCoin was on course to become the world's biggest cryptocurrency, quote, for everyone to make payments everywhere. To some people, it sounded like free money that would give them the financial freedom they're looking for. And all they had to do was hand over their money to invest and not worry about anything else. Duped investor. Plenty of people were convinced. For example, Jen McAdam, she invested 10,000 euros herself. Not only that, she persuaded family members to put in an additional 250,000 euros. People from over 175 countries invested back in 2016. Investors on the lower packages were convinced to invest in bigger packages because of the extra benefits. Of course, investors were shown the growth of their investments. The horrible truth was that those rising numbers were totally meaningless. They were just numbers typed into a computer by OneCoin employees. Jen was constantly told she was part of the OneCoin family. She had a OneCoin leader who got information from the headquarters in Bulgaria. and her leader prepared her carefully for conversations with any one-coin skeptics. Any criticism or awkward questions were actively discouraged. This is basically how cults work. You always have to be able to think for yourself, no matter the situation. Poorest investors. Here's the worst part. Remember when we said that OneCoin targeted tech-naive communities? Well, typically that also means poor. OneCoin targeted the poorest people because they're typically the people who were the least educated. For example, thousands of Ugandans bought into OneCoin. It took 700,000 Ugandan shillings, or roughly $250, to buy a OneCoin starter package. Poor investors became increasingly important to OneCoin. That's because in Europe, less money was invested in the first 6 months of 2017 compared to the same period of 2016. But in Africa, the Middle East, and in India, it was the complete opposite. As the money started drying up in Europe, promoters turned more and more to third world and emerging countries. When it comes to running a scam, they don't care who it is they scam, rich or poor, it doesn't matter. CTO recruiting. There were many people that doubted OneCoin as early as 2015. One such person was Bjorn Bjerk. After actually getting recruited by OneCoin, he investigated deep within the company. They had wanted him to be chief technical officer for them, so he did due diligence on them. And he became one of the first people to discover that there was no blockchain at all. There wasn't anything invested in any technology. Of course, when you're dealing with a scam involving billions of euros, there are going to be people that didn't want him to blow the whistle. According to Bjorn, he learned in his research that Ruja had never expected OneCoin to grow so big. It was never supposed to be a $1 billion scam. She actually tried to shut it down, but people in the underworld that she was connected to wouldn't let her since they were making so much money. Anyone that was interviewed about their involvement wouldn't discuss any of the players involved with organized crime except for one person. Too much. OneCoin grew to 10 million, then quickly to 20 million, then 30 million, and it just quickly snowballed into the billions. And with all the publicity stunts and all the investor money rolling in, one day, Ruja just disappeared. She was famously punctual. She was supposed to show up and talk at a European OneCoin promoter meetup in Lisbon, Portugal in October 2017. This was where she was supposed to answer brewing questions of why payments had been delayed. But she never showed up. However, even when she disappeared, the scheme didn't end. OneCoin kept running despite the controversy surrounding the scam. Konstantin Ignatov. And this is where her brother comes in. Konstantin took over as CEO of OneCoin. He continued in the footsteps of his sister even with the Ponzi scheme controversy going on. Let's be serious here. Does this guy look trustworthy? Also, really, he has the word con start his name. This simulation we're living in has a good sense of humor. Konstantin continued the scam and promised to take OneCoin above and beyond. He promised that an IPO of OneCoin would occur sometime between 2018 and 2019 and would make everyone rich. Obviously, the IPO repeatedly postponed, and it never took place. The aftermath. In March of 2018, Konstantin Ignatov was at LAX waiting to fly back to Bulgaria after some OneCoin meetings in the US. Just as he was boarding his flight home, FBI agents arrested him and charged him with fraud in connection with OneCoin. Ruja is still missing today. The last confirmed report is that she had flown to Athens back in October of 2017. She officially charged in absentia with money laundering. Her partner and lawyer, Sebastian Greenwood, was arrested around the same time as her brother. It's interesting seeing how her brother and her lawyer weren't smart enough to disappear. During his trial, Konstantin gave up information about his sister. According to him, she had gotten a passport and asked him to get her plane tickets to Vienna, Austria, and then Athens, Greece. Where is she today? Who knows? She can't run forever. One day, what she did will catch up with her. Konstantin eventually pleaded guilty in November 2019 to several charges that included money laundering and fraud as part of a plea deal. Yep, he decided to rat out his associates in the underworld. According to official court documents, at least he has the option of going in the witness protection program. The truth about people. Just how did so many people get duped? scammy sales tactics and persuasion. People fell hard for the time-sensitive sales tactics, and once they bought in, they were all in. It's psychology at this point. People don't want to admit they were ever wrong, so they just double down. No matter what the evidence is, it's just human nature to protect their reputation, intelligence, and identity. The fact of the matter is, the vast majority of people make irrational decisions. Then they rationalize their decision-making afterwards to make themselves feel better. Even more amazingly, even after Ruja, Constantine, and Sebastian were officially charged, people continued to invest in the coin. Despite all the evidence, investors simply just didn't want to miss out on the next big thing. Going for them was hope and prayers. He would have gotten away with stealing Guy Ferrari's Lambo, except he decided to do this instead. Flavortown Lambo. Imagine saying to yourself, you know what? Guy Fieri has a lot of money. He doesn't need his yellow Lambo anymore. I'm gonna go steal it. This is essentially what then 16-year-old Max Wade decided to do in 2011. Yep, this stolen yellow Lamborghini Gallardo belonged to the mayor of Flavortown. And he almost got away with it. In fact, he did get away with it. But he slipped up, almost as if on purpose. Who was Max Wade? Max Wade pretty much looked and seemed like any other teenager, except he was anything but. He had dropped out of high school in the 9th grade. It wasn't because he couldn't do the classes, he just didn't want to go to school anymore. He was actually quite smart, because the sophistication he showed in this heist was actually quite impressive for a 16-year-old kid. Before he dropped out of high school, he was already getting into trouble with the law. He had been investigated for allegedly detonating a stink bomb. He definitely had something against his mom because he had charges of battery against her and also charges for stealing her car. But the crime that showed off his business skills was his money-making scheme to sell fake IDs to his classmates. Apparently, he had already made 6 figures with that scheme by the time he did the heist. Pre-heist planning. Before Wade committed the actual crime, he spent weeks planning the heist of the Lamborghini. His computer history detailed just how dedicated he was to pulling the heist off. He found out on the internet how to jam a Lamborghini's auto theft prevention system called LoJack. He Googled instructions on how to pick a Lamborghini. He researched the place where he was going to steal the Lambo, British Motor Cars in San Francisco. He Googled the search phrase, Mission Impossible Style Repelling, something that he actually did exactly. The heist. Wade got into the dealership early in the morning on March 8, 2011. It's the middle of the night, really. Surveillance video catches the rope falling to the ground. Next thing on the screen you see is Wade scaling down the side of the building and into a window. That particular window was conveniently left unlocked. It's been theorized that Max was most likely working with someone on the inside, and that most likely person was the building's janitor. He wasn't supposed to be at work that late, but he was still somehow working at that time of night when the heist happened. And the crazy thing is, ever since the crime happened, detectives haven't been able to find him. Once he slipped in the window, Wade actually spent almost 15 minutes walking through the dealership. On the surveillance tape, it seemed like he had on a microphone and he looked like he was communicating to someone. He walks to the exit door and cuts the lock with bolt cutters. After that, he went straight for Guy's favorite Lamborghini and started the engine. He was able to drive out the door without tripping the dealership's motion sensors or perimeter alarms, something that was another mystery. Golden Gate Bridge cameras got surveillance of Guy Fieri's Lamborghini rolling through at 4:40 in the morning with the license plate Guy Toro. That was the last time the Lambo would be spotted with that license plate. When employees finally arrived at the dealership that same morning, they found the door still raised. They also found all the evidence. The climbing rope was in a duffel bag along with a pry bar and bolt cutters. No one besides Wade has ever been arrested in the case. Even though he left all that evidence behind, no one knew who committed the crime. Police had no clue who did it. They even had a tip that Wade had the car and actually interviewed him. But they could not make a case. It was only gossip around his old high school that he had taken credit for the crime and had the car. But police couldn't find anyone that had actually seen the Lambo. Everything seemed to be in the clear at this point for Max. GTA life. If you have access to a Lamborghini, let's be for real. You definitely have some fun with it, right? Because that's exactly what Wade did. He drove it around town fearlessly. Guy Fieri often got reports of sightings of his Lambo. According to Fieri, he said, quote, "We would get calls all the time, and I mean all the time. I had friends call me who would say, listen, I just saw your car on the freeway." People would report to police seeing a yellow Lamborghini, and Guy would hear reports about it from his lawyer, but that was the end of it. They couldn't pin it to anyone. Max Wade basically had gotten away with the crime, right? All he had to do was avoid getting pulled over. Or maybe he was smart enough to somehow come up with a fake registration and put it into the police system. However, Wade was a bit flashy. He did love driving the Lambo around, and he told friends that he did. He even texted a picture of the Lambo, along with the text, quote, "Doesn't get any better than boosting a Lambo and picking up chicks at 17. After committing a serious crime, you'd lay low for a while, right? Well, not Max Wade. He wanted to push it to the limit. He wanted to throw a party, except it wasn't at his own place. Max wanted to throw it at the biggest, fanciest house in his old neighborhood. It was a $7 million, 7,450-square-foot mansion at the highest point of Tiburon's Sugarloaf Drive. He knew that it was occupied for only part of the year, so of course, he decided to break in and throw a party. He told everyone that it was his house. He had plenty of cash and he drove a Lambo, so why wouldn't the kids who he threw the party for believe him? Throwing this party showed how much Wade wanted to be accepted. He didn't even know most of the kids that showed up. He was still susceptible to his human nature. Even with plenty of money, a stolen Lambo, and access to a huge mansion, he still had to be accepted by peers he didn't know. The downfall. So how exactly did police catch Wade? Well, they weren't exactly looking for him because of the Lambo. You see, what happened was that he had a little crush on someone that used to be his classmate, then 17-year-old Eva Dedier. Eva was one of Wade's potential fake ID customers, and that's when he started getting a crush on her. They texted back and forth, and Wade found out that she was seeing one of his old classmates, Landon Wallstrom. And this is where things took a weird turn. He planned this next crime on Friday, April the 13th of 2012. Wade is pulled up outside a house on a motorcycle, dressed in all black. He watches as Eva and Landon walk out of a house and climb into his pickup truck. And that's when Wade pulled up and started shooting. Luckily for them, Wade was a terrible shot, and he dropped the gun by accident. That allowed Eva and Landon to take off in the truck unhurt. Wade got away from the scene of the crime, and it looked like he was about to get away with it. But it was bad luck for Wade that the two detectives assigned to the case were motorcycle enthusiasts. They recognized the brand of the helmet Wade had on, called Bilt. This was a brand that could only be bought at special motorcycle stores. Detectives were able to find him on camera, filling up at a nearby gas station shortly before the shooting. Then detectives were able to find the store that Wade went to buy, matching his description from the gas station video. The motorcycle store had a clear video of him with his face clearly showing behind the helmet and the same black outfit he wore. Detectives showed Eva the video and she identified the shooter as Wade. That was a wrap for him. The detectives now knew exactly who he was. But the problem is, they didn't have a current address for him, so they had to wait him out. But the funny thing is, after the shooting, Wade contacted Eva again about getting her a fake ID. He wanted to go out with her this bad. He even had offered to pick her up in the Lambo. He had no clue that she knew it was him, so she set up a date with him. Detectives and a team of 10 officers were waiting at their meeting spot, which was at a storage facility where Wade had a spot rented. And when Wade saw the officers, Wade ran. But officers were able to tackle and arrest him, and from then on, it was all over for him. the contents. Inside the storage unit, investigators found Guy's long-lost yellow Lamborghini. A sales contract found inside the locker showed that Wade had planned to ship the car out of Oakland and sell it to a dealership in the Dominican Republic. The storage unit also contained a fake San Francisco Police Department uniform, guns, ammunition, radio signal jammers, and other burglary equipment. Detectives found evidence that Wade was planning to steal around $6 million in merchandise from a San Francisco jewelry store in a heist that involved an escape by helicopter. It looked like Wade was going to go on an entire life of crime. More importantly, police found the motorcycle and the helmet he had used in the crime that they used to convict him. Wade had rented the storage unit under the name Carmine Colombo, which he had a fake ID for. You would think that for a guy who was smart enough to steal a Lambo in a sophisticated fashion, he'd be smart enough not to shoot some dude that was dating a girl he liked. But no, there's a lesson in here somewhere. It's probably something along the lines of, teenagers will think like teenagers and you can't change human nature. Aftermath. But wait, it gets even better. After he was sent to jail, his friends actually tried to break him out of jail with a sledgehammer. His friends knew he was held at Marin County Juvenile Hall. So what'd they do? They decided to try to break him out at around 4:30 in the morning on a random Friday night. Staff members heard banging on the walls of the facility, so they went outside to see what was going on. They saw two kids out there with a sledgehammer, but they quickly ran and ended up not being caught. Police found holes cut into two perimeter fences, a sledgehammer, bolt cutters, and a damaged window at Wade's cell. Yes, for a few years this kid was living the real-life version of Grand Theft Auto. Find out how this girl made off with millions and never got caught. Except, there's a twist. Heather Tallchief looked like the girl next door type of girl. She was pretty, she was young, and she had an innocent look about her. When she made off with over $4 million, her coworkers didn't even have any suspicion that she had something to do with it. They figured that she was kidnapped instead. And no, it wasn't that far-fetched to assume she was kidnapped. That's because kidnapping was an inherent risk with the type of job they had, which was being an armored car driver. They were responsible for transporting large amounts of cash. They just had no clue how cunning Heather actually was and what she was capable of. Just who exactly was Heather Tallchief? Before Heather became America's most wanted woman, Heather Tallchief moved to Las Vegas in 1993. She had needed a change. Before the Vegas move, she worked as a nurse at a hospice called Kimberly Quality Care Center in San Francisco. Her coworkers were sad that she was moving on. According to them, she had this amazing empathy with patients. Even the patients closest to leaving would be smiling when she left their bedside. But in the 14 months Heather worked in the hospice, she saw many patients go. She had become close friends to a few of them. Of course, this began to affect her. She began to be depressed because of her job. According to her mom, she began to wonder why she couldn't be happy. Heather didn't have the greatest circumstances in her life up to that point. She was born in Buffalo, New York, a place with sub-zero temperatures for 6 months out of the year. Heather hated every moment she spent in Buffalo. Almost every day, she begged her mom and to leave. One day, she got her wish. Ann Tallchief packed up everything she owned and moved to San Francisco with Heather, leaving Heather's dad behind. And now, Heather couldn't take everything falling apart at her work. She said she didn't want to worry about anything anymore. That's when she decided to uproot her entire life, move to Las Vegas. In Vegas, Heather decided on a strange career move. She applied for work as an armored vehicle driver supplying cash to casinos. How did she even get an interview for that job without any experience at all? She used her exceptional work record at the hospice to apply for jobs as an armored car driver. She also had perfect credit, and Kimberly gave her a glowing reference. She was way above the average for the industry. It may have looked like an odd choice to her interviewers, but she had a perfectly plausible explanation. She said she wanted a career in the security industries. She wanted to start at the bottom to learn the industry inside out. In a profession dominated by large men, she stood out. But that's the only thing she had against her. She easily passed the background criminal record check. Her references were perfect. She was on. She was hired at Loomis. At first, like most new drivers at Loomis, Heather was assigned to the casino house runs. This involved transporting new bills to thousands of gaming tables each day at different casinos. Even though this seems like it's really risky to the company and the casino, it wasn't. These new bills are easily traceable. These aren't the bills criminals want to be stuck with. Heather was patient. She had plenty of opportunities to go after the new bills, but she didn't go for it. She was waiting for a promotion. What she was waiting for were the ATM runs. That's where Loomis employees moved millions of dollars of used, unmarked bills. Those runs were given only to the most trusted employees. Somehow, within 6 months, Heather was just that. In her first weeks in her new job, Heather took a firing range test to qualify for a gun. The crazy thing was, she was really great at shooting. She shocked her coworkers by achieving record scores. Although she had 20/20 vision, Heather wore what looked like thick glasses whenever she was in her Loomis uniform. Heather also applied for admission at local law enforcement colleges, which increased the trust placed in her by Loomis. After just a couple months, Loomis felt that she had proved her innocence. Her diligence and reliability on the house runs had paid off. She was promoted to one of the riskier parts of the business at Loomis, ATM runs. 5 days a week, she would drive millions of dollars in unmarked bills to the strip. Heather's two closest co-workers were guards Steve Marshall and Scott Stewart. They rode with her in the armored truck and handled all the actual deliveries of the cash to the ATMs. They both liked her because she had made a considerable effort to be nice to them. She asked about their families and she remembered details of their friends and kids. All that effort to be friends with them, along with her incredible charm, meant that she had Marshall and Stewart's total trust. Trust to the extent that they would allow her to drive the truck without them in certain circumstances. On the outside, everything looked normal. Here was a girl who was making a new start and a new career, and she was the model employee. But of course, you know that Heather had her own real plan. Before applying to work for Loomis, Heather's first move was to establish a series of fake IDs. What she would do was contact passport collectors. These were mostly guys who sold new passports from defunct countries such as Czechoslovakia. She would then go to small towns and get a driver's license in the name of her fake IDs. By the time she was in Vegas, she already had real driver's licenses in 12 different names. She also began applying for credit cards in the names of her new driving licenses. She took flying lessons as well, so she was in and out of the airports in Las Vegas. She took her first solo flight in a Cessna in August of 1993. Heather, however, wasn't hanging out in Las Vegas on her own. Her mom knew that she moved to Las Vegas with a man named Roberto Salas, and she had a bad feeling about him. That's because Roberto Salas is a convicted bank robber. He left prison early because he wrote poetry that got the attention of prominent literary figures in San Francisco. Supposedly, Heather wrote to him while he was in jail and arranged a meeting when he was released. Roberto and Heather lived together in a high-rise building in Las Vegas. High-rises in Vegas are places where people can just blend right in with plenty of privacy. Vegas is a place where people don't ask too many questions. A couple weeks before the big day, Heather, disguised as a nurse, pushed Roberto, disguised as a rich old guy in a wheelchair, onto a private jet at Las Vegas Airport. She was establishing a pattern that would remove suspicion after the robbery. On September 24th, Heather booked the same jet for a flight on October 1st. On September 18th, using the name Myra Calandra, Heather called an apartment building in Denver that specializes in furnished rentals business travel. She made a reservation for a couple weeks. At around the same time, she rented a garage in Las Vegas and registered it to a business called Reinforced Steel. She informed the owners that Reinforced Steel builds and repairs armored vehicles. Heather chose October 1st, 1993 as D-Day. Why that day? Heather knew the convention schedule. That day is when one convention started and another one just ended. It's when traffic is at its heaviest. parking at some hotels, such as Circus Circus and MGM Grand, became impossible. On that particular day, it was one of the biggest changeover days in 1993. Heather left the Loomis Depot early in the morning, along with more than $6 million cash. By the time she arrived at the back of Circus Circus Casino, there was over $4.5 million left. Her co-workers, Stewart and Marshall, were scheduled to put in $400,000 cash to five ATMs inside. Heather knew that it would take them at least 45 minutes. There wasn't any parking at the casino, just as Heather had predicted. They both agreed to let Heather meet them at the front of the hotel at 10:15, just like any other time. And that's when Heather took off for the garage reserved for reinforced steel, which definitely was not at the front of the Circus Circus Casino. How many millions of dollars did she get away with? It's up for debate. Some newspapers say around $4 million, some newspapers say it's $3 million. The exact figure doesn't matter. What matters was that she disappeared with Roberto, and they were nowhere to be found. From trash found in the garage, it's clear Heather had also planned how to get the money out of Las Vegas. Packing materials had showed that Heather had packed the cash into boxes and had the money shipped to Denver. Heather didn't seem particularly tense that morning, according to Stewart's later recollection, but her dressier shoes did strike him as out of the ordinary. He just thought that maybe she was going out to dinner or something after work and needed to get changed quickly. Roughly 2 hours later, at around 11 in the morning, Heather, using a fake nurse's ID, helped push Roberto onto his private jet at Las Vegas Airport. A short 12 minutes later, their plane pulled away and took off. As her plane was in the air, her co-workers were calling the Las Vegas Police Department. They were reporting that Heather had been kidnapped. Even the police thought that they'd find her body out in the desert. It was a full 2 weeks before the garage owner became suspicious, since their garage wasn't busy like usual. Inside, they found the Loomis truck, $3,000 in $1 bills, a pair of thick glasses, and packing material. It was another week before the FBI located the apartment building in Denver. And just like that, Heather Tallchief disappeared for good. According to the FBI, her case is one of the largest armored robberies where the perpetrator wasn't brought to justice. And of course, things get even weirder. Police couldn't find Roberto or Heather for over a decade. Except one day, out of the blue, Heather showed up and surrendered at the federal courthouse in Las Vegas on September 15, 2005. Over the years, Las Vegas detectives were baffled at how Heather and her suspected accomplice Roberto had not been caught. They were about to find out. Heather told police she had been in Europe much of the time. Apparently, she never had access to the money except for a short while. She had been in Amsterdam working as a hotel maid for years. According to her, she was not the mastermind behind the crime. She claimed to be brainwashed by Roberto. She admitted to doing everything with Roberto, but she said that she couldn't help it. She claimed that Roberto constantly showed her tapes that hypnotized her after she met him. Apparently, the tapes made her receptive to his commands. He was the one who convinced her to move to Las Vegas. He was the one who told her to get work at Loomis. He was the one who planned the heist. He was the one who gave her all the instructions. According to Heather, she had followed Roberto's instructions like a robot, and she could remember very little about the planning. After driving off her route with the truck, she said she drove to a warehouse, but she didn't know what happened to the money she helped to pack. But why? Why on earth would she come turn herself in? Heather Tallchief basically had a moment of clarity and felt bad about her role in the heist. She wanted to do the right thing and turn herself in. However, she didn't know where Roberto was, but here's another twist. They have a son together, but she left him after she learned she was pregnant because Roberto had not treated her well, especially after their son was born. She felt that it was best for her and her son to run on their own, something they did in Europe for roughly 10 years. But enough was enough. She was tired of running, and she wanted a chance for life for her then 10-year-old son if she did her time. Heather was sentenced to 63 months in prison. In June of 2010, she was released on parole. Find out exactly just how simple it was for two students to scam Apple thousands of times. If you found a way to easily scam a giant corporation that's already extremely rich, would you? That's the question two engineering students asked themselves. And the answer was a resounding yes. Because these guys didn't try to scam Apple just once, or twice, or three times. They tried an astounding 3,069 times. These two guys were able to scam Apple out of roughly $900,000 by essentially doing a phone switcheroo, which we're going to get into in just a minute. According to federal prosecutors, it was an elaborate scheme that involved roping in friends and family while using completely fake names. If you can even call it that. We're talking about names that sometimes made zero sense. And oh yeah, they needed a lot of different mailing addresses. So how'd they do it? Well, first they needed phones. Not real phones, but fake iPhones. And those fake iPhones all come from one place. Yep, you guessed it, China. Court documents outline a scenario in which the two men imported thousands of counterfeit iPhones. Yangyang Zhu, who had just completed his engineering degree at Oregon State University before his scamming career started, was the one responsible for getting the counterfeit shipments into the US. Of course, the iPhones they used were just a prop. What they would do is go to the Apple store and buy a real iPhone, so nothing crazy there. They then would file a warranty complaint with Apple by claiming the smartphones were broken. Now, you would think that Apple would easily be able to figure out whether or not an iPhone is real or not. This is true, theoretically they can, but here's where the trick is really good. The counterfeit iPhones were essentially just a bricked iPhone. They'd never turn on. And because they never turned on, Apple was never able to verify the authenticity of the phone. Apple would then replace the counterfeit phones with real iPhones. And then these guys would ship the real phones to China, where the guys resell the iPhones for a profit. Yangyang Zhu and his partner Quan Zhang were both engineering students in the US on F1 student visas at the time. Zhu was caught just in time as he was trying to leave for China from San Francisco International Airport back in August of 2018. Maybe he knew, or maybe he didn't, but his partner Zhang had already laid out the entire operation in a December 2017 interview with Special Agent Thomas Duffy. Zhang admitted that he received phones from an associate in China, and it was anywhere from 20 to 30 at a time. But how was he able to receive thousands of phones? Well, he used friends, relatives, and variations of his own name to receive packages from China, as well as the replacement phones from Apple. This sounds careful, right? But no, he didn't care about being careful. Because one time, Zhang actually used the name Apache Helicopter to file a claim. And the warranty claim using that name actually still got through, and he got a new iPhone. We understand that they may have been running out of names here, but they really didn't need to get stupid with it, right? Zhang explained that he deliberately coordinated the iPhone shipments to different addresses in the US in order to avoid the packages being detained by customs. His own mom was in the operation because she allegedly collected his share of the profits in China and then deposited the money into an account he can access in the US. Apple told investigators that 3,069 warranty claims were linked to either Zhang or Zhu. 1,493 of those claims were processed and replacement devices were mailed out. Apple claimed a loss of $600 for each iPhone. In total, Apple estimated that they were scammed out of $895,800. It turns out that it was nearly a 50-50 gamble on whether Apple could be scammed or not. And these guys kept on doing it. Because even if the warranty failed the first time, they'd just try again with a different name and a different address with the same phone. The claims that didn't get through were rejected because Apple had found tampering with the phones. So they would just return the phones back to them along with a letter explaining why their warranty claim had been denied. Zhang and Zhu were able to use their own names dozens of times. Isn't that a red flag in and of itself? Even for company phones, wouldn't the employee use their own name? However, the most interesting thing is none of the phones were identified as counterfeit. But why? What's the process over there at Apple anyways? Don't you think that there are plenty of people that try this, so Apple would be extra careful? But aha! Because Apple never identified any fake phones, that suggests that Zhang and Zhu had to have access to authentic iPhone serial numbers, or rather, International Mobile Equipment Identity numbers, also called IMEI numbers. The IMEI includes information on the origin, model, and serial number of the phone. Also, these fake iPhones can now be made to be so convincing that even Apple engineers believe they're authentic. But Apple finally figured things out as early as June 30th, 2017, when its legal counsel sent Zhang a cease and desist letter. That's because, by that time, Zhang had used that same address the letter was sent to file 150 different warranty claims. The funny thing is, Zhang didn't respond, so Apple had its lawyers send a second letter. So, how'd these guys figure out where to get real IMEI numbers? Or even to access the fake iPhones that look completely real? Police couldn't figure it out. But it didn't matter, these guys were already caught. Zhang faced charges of trafficking in counterfeit goods and wire fraud. Zhu was charged with submitting false or misleading information on export declaration. But who really was the brains of the operation? Apparently, it was Zhang. Although they both claimed that they didn't know the phones they had were counterfeit, only Zhu got off. He somehow was able to have all the charges against him dismissed. As for Zhang, yeah, because he was the mastermind, he got 37 months in federal prison. Just how did this scammer get hopeless romantics to send him cash? Ruben Sarpong would routinely hit up women on online dating sites looking for romance. Plenty of Fish, OkCupid, Tinder, whatever you could think of, he was on there messaging women. He would message and quickly sweet talk women looking for love, but then he'd quickly turn the conversation into a promise of getting rich. Between January 2016 and September of 2019, Sarpong and his squad worked together to scam women in New Jersey and the surrounding area on online dating apps. His accomplices lived in Ghana while he lived in the US. What he and the team would do is set up fake dating profiles all over the place on various dating websites such as Match.com, OurTime.com, and Plenty of Fish. It goes without saying that they would always use a fake person identity. Sometimes they'd go through the trouble of making fake IDs as well. They also had to set up numerous email addresses, numerous phone numbers, and numerous bank accounts. And most of the time, they posed as US military stationed overseas. But why the military? Hey, do us a quick favor and hit that like button. Simply put, it's because of the fact that being in the military just makes things much easier for scammers in general. The fact that military personnel are stationed outside the US makes it easy for scammers to make up excuses why they don't have something a normal person would have when someone asks them questions. They can just blame everything on the fact that they're overseas in the military. Plus, there's the whole secrecy thing that they can play up with the government at play. Hundreds of times a day, women all over the world are being conned by scammers posing as US service members. This is according to Chris Gray from the U.S. Army Criminal Investigation Command. They literally get hundreds of calls a day about dating scams. Most of the victims are women in the U.S. They mostly range from their late 30s to late 70s. You'd think that it would be someone who's dumb and uneducated. Nope. Gray says that education does not matter. Plenty of highly educated people get scammed as well. According to Gray, there's one easy step to avoid getting scammed by a military imposter. Just ask to be sent an email from his or her military account ending in .mil. Gray says the scammers will do everything they can to get around this email check. They'll just quickly make up another lie, such as saying they're on a top secret mission. Hotspots for online romance scams include Nigeria and other countries in West Africa. But today, there's only a small number of personnel in the West African region. For example, fewer than 50 military and civilian employees and contractors are in Nigeria. After Sarpong establishes some virtual sparks with the women, this is when the real work starts. He starts asking them for help in the form of money. For Sarpong, gold was always involved. Sarpong would make up that money was needed for the purpose of paying to get gold bars into the US. The stories that Sarpong and his team uses aren't the same every time. They tailor it for each woman. Most of the time, Sarpong would claim to be a soldier stationed in Syria. He'd say he either received, found, or was awarded gold bars. He's now rich, but he had a problem. He didn't have enough cash on hand to ship the gold bars himself. There were taxes to be paid, shipping fees, and other fake invoices that needed to be paid in order to get the gold to the US. He'd tell the women that their money would be returned once the gold bars were back to the States, and of course, they'd get a lot more money back for their efforts. Let's get into some details with this scam. One unidentified and unfortunate lady we'll call scam victim number one went back and forth with Sarpong. He told her that he was stationed in Syria and his unit had recovered millions of dollars worth of gold bars. He told this lady that he was given one of the boxes of gold and that the box was worth $12 million. Why do people fall for this? Has anyone heard of the military ever giving away gold bars to soldiers? Anyways, Sarpong started asking her if she could help him get the bars back to the US once he knew she was hooked. And this is where Sarpong usually have the ladies talk to one of his team members just so they could build some trust in the ladies' minds. In this instance, someone on his squad posed as a diplomat named Alwyn Rolf Liss. He was supposed to help her help Sarpong with the transfer of the gold back to the US. This fake diplomat would have the perfect answer for every one of her questions. How come Liss didn't have his own US bank account? Because he wasn't a US citizen. So he had the victim wire her money to his secretary's bank account. He told her this was the account he used whenever he arranged gold deliveries for people. Of course, that bank account actually belonged to Sarpong. Even after the victim wired the money over, they would keep talking to her. Why would they do this? If they found someone who would send money one time, why wouldn't they send money a second time? Or a third time? Or maybe a fourth time? The money just keeps coming until the women realize they're getting scammed. Basically, they're going for max value per scam here. A few days later, fake diplomat Liss told victim number one the good news. He would be flying from Syria to New York and then to Maryland with the gold. He emailed a copy of a fake airway bill that showed the two trunks with the quote, family treasure that were being shipped to her. The fake airway bill had her address on it. They really tried to make it seem like she was getting the gold. He was listed as the delivery agent, but there was one problem. There would be extra costs. Liss also attached a copy of a fake United Nations identity card that showed that he was an Israeli citizen and an official delivery agent for the UN. Also, he told her that way she would recognize him when she picked him up at the airport. From approximately May 22, 2018 to June 12, 2018, Sarpong and his scam team successfully scammed almost $94,000 from this particular lady running this usual military play. But Sarpong didn't always go after women, and he didn't always use the military. He went after at least one man. Sarpong pretended to be a lady who was living in Florida in one instance. Sarpong played a lady who was waiting on a large inheritance that was mostly in gold from her dad's estate in Ghana. Because whose dad wouldn't have their assets mostly in gold? We'll call this guy scammer victim number two, or number two for short. Sarpong told number two an attorney named Mumuni Muhammad was helping her get her inheritance to the US, but she needed funds in order to cover the court costs, airway bills, document fees, export fees, and taxes. She's now rich, but she just didn't have cash on hand. Their scam is just a spin-off of the Nigerian prince scam, right? Muhammad had instructed number two to wire the money to Sarpong, who Muhammad would refer to as one of his sons in New Jersey. And when number two asked why his son had a different last name, he would just make up a different lie. You would think these scammers would be extremely careful, but they're really not. They make up a lot of sophisticated sounding lies, but they still make mistakes on the fly. But what helps them also is just a little glimmer of hope for love and money from the victim. Muhammad ended up making the excuse that Sarpong was someone who used to work for him and that he misspoke. This guy still sent the money anyways, all for the hope of even more money coming back along with getting to help someone who he thinks is a real woman. Number two eventually wired a little over $300,000 to Sarpong and his team. Of the roughly $2.1 million that they were able to scam out of people, about 40% went to Sarpong, and the remaining money went to the rest of the team. So what did Sarpong do with his portion? If you check out Sarpong's Instagram, he was definitely desperate for attention. You can just tell he wanted the world to know that he was living it up. He craved the validation of a successful businessman. The sad thing is that no one really paid attention. None of his posts have that many likes. Ultimately, he did these scams and made some money. Instead of saving the money and trying not to get caught, here he was blowing the money on random frivolous things and posting it online. It's like he almost wanted to get caught. Investigators eventually caught on to Sarpong and his team. They said that he was the ringleader of the international operation that scammed over 30 women. He was charged in federal court with just a single count of conspiracy to commit wire fraud. And he was the only one actually charged because everyone else was international. Here's the craziest thing. He actually asked a judge to assign him to a public defender. Why? Because he claimed he didn't have enough money to pay for a lawyer. Here are some of the craziest pyramid schemes that people fell for. Find out just exactly how emus actually became part of a giant scam. Number 9. Pastor Hibbert. Former Pastor Marlon Hibbert and his wife Verna ran an $8.6 million Ponzi scheme by tricking members of their own church. They got their congregation to invest a minimum of $10,000 for a guaranteed 8.5% return on their investment. How did they actually make that return? They didn't. They paid the returns with new cash they got from new investors. You know, the good old-fashioned textbook pyramid scheme. They didn't invest the money and showed fake returns to anyone looking to invest. Toronto police did a financial audit and found that roughly 200 people gave them $8.6 million. The Hibberts used that money to bankroll an extravagant lifestyle. They bought cars, a huge house, and expensive trips while their victims watched their retirement go down in flames. Some people even lost their homes because they invested everything. The victims said they believed their money was safe because Mr. Hibbert was a pastor. Number 8. Latex gloves. In 2014, a guy by the name of Deepal Wanakuwate was charged with operating a Ponzi scheme that took in more than $230 million. Wanakuwate was able to convince investors that they had a massive government contract. He ran two companies, International Manufacturing Group and RelyAid. He misled investors into thinking that he had a massive contract with the United States Department of Veterans Affairs. He told investors his companies had contracts worth more than $100 million a year selling the government latex gloves. Of course, Wanakuwate had false documents and relationships to show investors. He had fake tax returns, overstating income, fake corporate documents, and he even had a fake Veteran Affairs representative. Number 7. Lou Pearlman. Do you remember Lou Pearlman? Lou Pearlman was the mastermind behind boy bands such as Backstreet Boys and NSYNC, and the mastermind of huge Ponzi schemes. But we'll get into that in just a minute. The Backstreet Boys and NSYNC dominated the late 90s and early 2000s. Pearlman became sort of a music mogul, and he created other boy bands such as LFO and Take 5. However, things went south for him when the Backstreet Boys filed a lawsuit against him. Each band member was only paid $300,000 for their work, while Pearlman made millions. But this was the least of his worries because he was running huge Ponzi schemes. In 2006, federal prosecutors found out that he had cheated investors out of more than $300 million through a fake company he pretended to own. He used a company called Transcontinental Airlines in order to lure investors into giving him a ton of money for over 20 years. After investors began getting suspicious, he went on the run across the world. He was finally apprehended in Germany in 2007. He pleaded guilty to his crimes and was sentenced to 25 years in prison. In a bizarre interview in 2014, Pearlman actually bragged that his Ponzi scheme was better than Bernie Madoff's. Number 6. Nu Skin. If you ever encounter a multi-level marketing company, always ask if it's a scam. Even the Federal Trade Commission has looked intensely at the operations at Nu Skin. Technically, multi-level marketing is a legitimate business model, But most people that get into it lose money. We're talking literally 99% of people. This is a number the government themselves estimated. It goes like this. New skin gets new recruits. They get the recruits to buy new skin products with promises of a lot of money. And the recruits are supposed to sell it to anyone they can. That and get other people to sign on to sell more new skin products. But ultimately, the people that buy the most products are the recruits themselves. New Skin Enterprises is still operating today, but the company has had many issues. Back in the 90s, the company was investigated by the US government and had to pay out a series of fines in 1992, 1994, and 1997. Even the Chinese government sued the company. In 2014, New Skin agreed to pay $47 million in a settlement to the Chinese government. Although companies such as New Skin may not technically be pyramid schemes, they might as well be. What do you think? Speaking of New Skin, we might as well get into number 5, Herbalife. This company is another multi-level marketing company that markets and sells dietary supplements. But since its beginning in 1980, the company had been plagued by legal problems. They're just like New Skin, except their scale is even bigger. Herbalife's critics say all the company does is exploit poor people by getting them to pay thousands of dollars for products the company knows they won't be able to sell. They claim that the company purposely tricks people with dreams of getting rich quickly. In 2012, hedge fund manager Bill Ackman investigated Herbalife and concluded that they're running a very sophisticated pyramid scheme. By his estimate, low-level distributors of Herbalife lost around $3.5 billion a year. Herbalife denied this, but they decided to settle a class action lawsuit in 2014 in the amount of $6 million anyway. As part of the agreement, the company admitted no fault. In 2016, the Federal Trade Commission said that it's virtually impossible to make money as a Herbalife representative. Number 4. Sundown Entertainment. Sundown Entertainment was a comic book company that somehow scammed almost $4 million from unsuspecting people. Daniel Perilli, John Lauer, and Christopher Anderson had actually already all been in prison together before running this Ponzi scheme. These guys were all white-collar criminals serving time for various financial crimes. Obviously, they weren't rehabilitated when they had gotten out. When they got out, they formed a company called Sundown Entertainment. They claimed to be buying and selling the rights to films and comic books. They sold more than $7 million and essentially stocked their company to approximately 150 investors. They lured investors of returns of anywhere from 25% to 100% profit in as little as 7 days. Why didn't the investors do any due diligence on these guys? Sundown Entertainment obviously weren't making any deals and investors lost their money. All three of them were all sent back to prison once they were caught. Number 3. Telex Free. Labor Rosario was a guy who thought that hiding $17 million underneath his bed was a good hiding place. And that money was obtained from one of the biggest Ponzi schemes ever through a company called Telex Free. Telex Free was a company started in 2012 that was supposed to be providing an internet-based phone service that allowed free calls between Brazil and Latin America. The company brought in millions from investors who paid money to post online ads in exchange for a future return on investment. The company basically took the money and just told the investors to recruit more people into the scam. Needless to say, no product or service was actually sold. The scheme collapsed in 2014 after Telex Free eventually got around $3 billion from almost 2 million people. Co-founder James Merrill was arrested. His partner in crime, Carlos Wanzeller, fled to Brazil. However, Wanzeller left a good bit of cash behind, so he sent Rosario back to Massachusetts where the money was hidden. Things didn't go as planned, and Rosario was arrested by police. He decided to cooperate with officials, so he took them to Wanzeller's apartment where they easily found the cash. Number 2. Susie Emu Farms. Who comes up with a way to scam thousands of people of roughly $50 million? A guy named MS Guru, who owned Susie Emu Farms. Authorities had to deal not only with the thousands of victims, but they also had to deal with the estimated 100,000 emus abandoned when the scheme collapsed. Back in 2006, this guru guy got the brilliant idea to make money off unsuspecting investors with emus. He marketed emus as a great opportunity with multiple revenue opportunities by selling emu eggs, emu meat, and emu oil. Except there was no actual business plan by them. His company offered investors the promise of a steady income in return for raising an emu chick. The long story short is that people gave money and were given an actual emu chick to raise. But all the company did was just take in more money from more investors, and they had no plan to do anything with the emus. More and more people decided to hop on the scheme, and even other companies got in on the scam. The emus just kept piling up all over. Thousands of Indians chose to invest with Susie Emu Farms. Many people mortgaged their house or dipped into their savings to increase their investment. This crazy emu Ponzi scheme finally fell apart almost 6 years later in 2012. Roughly $50 million were taken from some 12,000 investors. Investigators began looking into charges against five major firms, the worst of which was Susie Emu Farms, founded by the original mastermind MS Guru. Number 1. OneCoin. OneCoin was a money heist that took billions of dollars from investors between 2014 and 2018. The brains behind this scheme was Ruja Ignatova. Although the US government previously estimated OneCoin's take at $4 billion, there are sources that claim the worldwide take was as much as $15.8 billion as of early 2018. We're not gonna go too deep into it, but if you want to find out all the details, be sure to check it out here in this video. What made OneCoin so attractive to investors? It was its viral, commission-driven structure again. It was sold to many vulnerable individuals, such as members of the working class in England and South Asia. This scam quickly became one of the biggest the world has ever seen. OneCoin grew to 10 million, then quickly to 20 million, then 30 million, and it just quickly snowballed into the billions. And with all the publicity stunts and all the investor money rolling in, one day Ruja just disappeared. Even more amazingly, even after Ruja was officially charged, people continued to invest in the coin. Despite all the evidence, investors simply just didn't want to miss out on the next big thing. Thank you, Lord, for the many blessings in my life. Continue to shame those waiting for me to be shamed. Hushpuppi posted this caption just 2 weeks before Dubai police raided his luxury home. Anyone that actually thought Hushpuppi was a scammer and wanted to see him get caught didn't have to wait that long after that Instagram post. Just how did he make it so easy for the police to catch him? Let's first get into it. How did Hushpuppi make his money? It definitely was not from real estate, as he claimed. It seems that all his money was from scamming. Hushpuppi and his team weren't slouches in this department. They're probably as good as it gets when it comes to scamming. Most of the time, they were trying to scam some big business. This is what the feds call a BEC scam, which stands for Business Email Compromise Scams. BEC schemes are one of the most difficult cybercrimes to track for law enforcement. This is because the scammers are typically scattered all around the world, and it's tough to get jurisdiction to apprehend the entire team of scammers. Just how big of a problem are BEC scams? Well, in 2019, the FBI recorded $1.7 billion in losses by companies and individuals who were victims of this specific type of scam. Hushpuppi and his team definitely contributed to that number with the businesses they targeted. Here's the basic overall plan on what they do. Hushpuppi and his team would hack into emails at a large targeted company. To be able to do this already shows sophistication. First, they would just scan for emails that caught their eye. They're looking for emails that were between different companies that are sending money to each other for any reason. Most of the time, it was just one company billing the other for services or products. So Hushpuppi and his team would just sit, and then they'd wait. And they'd follow the email correspondence between the companies. They'd need to gather contextual details. Why? So when they took over, the scammed company would feel as if they're still talking to the same person and have no suspicion whatsoever. Once they have all the details, they're ready to take over. They would simply redirect emails to their own email account. They'll act like the company with the product or service. They would email the paying, currently getting scammed customer and say that they have a new bank account, so course, the customer is thinking they're still talking to the same trusted person. They would send money to the new bank account, and just like that, the company's money would be gone. Hushpuppi's team was responsible for hacking and tricking the companies into wiring money into the wrong bank accounts. Hushpuppi himself was responsible for opening the bank accounts. His specialty was being able to find bank accounts where large amounts of money could be sent without any alerts or suspicions. The cash trail would disappear right after his team of money mules would buy Bitcoin with the stolen money. One question you may be asking is, why are so many scams from Nigeria in the first place? According to Nigerian economist Ibuka Ebina, it's because Nigerian culture is one where people believe that just the results speak to you. According to him, Nigerians don't place as much emphasis on how someone made their money. Just the fact that they have money is good enough. Nigerians first got famous for running scams right at the time the internet started becoming mainstream in the 90s. It definitely did not take long for Nigerians to become famous for scamming gullible Westerners out of millions of dollars with the start of the infamous Nigerian print scam. One interesting fact is that scammers actually are able to take advantage of everyone knowing that Nigeria is famous for scamming. Did you know that they actually intentionally say they're from Nigeria in any variations of the famous Nigerian print scheme? But why? The reason is because then they quickly filter out the people who are not gullible because they're a giant waste of time. The scammers intentionally target the most gullible people within the population. This is also the reason why these phishing emails are filled with typos and bad grammar. These scams became widely known as 419s because of the section of the Nigerian penal code of these types of crimes. The first wave of Nigerian 419 scammers were mostly uneducated, but then the next wave were young and well-educated. Young Nigerians were frustrated by the lack of good jobs in the Nigerian economy and because of widespread corruption in the government. The uneducated scammers ended up being the rich guys throwing money around partying with government officials. So many young Nigerians simply decided to join them. Another reason is that a lot of early Nigerian scammers actually established legitimate businesses and became respected philanthropists or even politicians in senior leadership positions. Obviously, this leads to many young Nigerians considering scamming a valid way to start off a career. And many of them just never leave the profession because they felt that there aren't other ways to make it rich in Nigeria. So who was Ray Hushpuppi, or Hush, anyways? His real name is Raymond Olarunwa Abbas. He was born in Nigeria, but he lived in Dubai running his scams. And once he started making boatloads of money, he started documenting his lifestyle on Instagram. A big mistake, because that's why investigators started getting interested in his personal life. Federal agents began wondering how on earth someone named Hushpuppi was able to live such an extravagant lifestyle. This guy called himself the billionaire Gucci master. No wonder the feds started getting interested. FBI special agent Andrew Incinetti started diving into Hushpuppi's world. He went through hundreds of images on his Instagram account. He saw all the images that showed Hushpuppi in designer clothes, exotic cars, and expensive watches. Incinetti noticed that Hushpuppi wrote he did real estate in Dubai for a living. Once Incinetti started poking around on his Instagram, he got a federal search warrant to access data and conversations between Hushpuppi and his team on their iPhones. He figured that Hushpuppi wasn't in real estate at all. He stole untold millions of dollars from many different big businesses. For Incinetti, putting everything together wasn't hard. Hushpuppi's Instagram had an email and phone number saved for account security purposes. Incinetti was able to link the email and phone number from his Instagram account to transactions and transfers he used through a variety of scams. It was that simple. His Apple and Snapchat records also provided information that helped Incinetti confirm his real identity and his address in Dubai. Everything he posted on Instagram was a helpful clue. For example, his birthday celebration posts on Instagram helped to confirm his actual birthday that Incinetti found on his official records. The date that he posted his birthday cake was the key here. This was how Incinetti knew Hushpuppi was really Raymond Olarunwa Abbas. UAE investigators eventually raided his apartment at the Palazzo Versace in Dubai in an operation they called Fox Hunt 2. Dubai police seized cash worth more than $40 million and 13 different exotic cars. They confiscated 21 different computers and 47 phones. They also got files with addresses of close to 2 million different possible victims. Yeah, Hushpuppi didn't run a small operation here. They handed him over to FBI agents who flew him back to Chicago personally in July of 2020. The biggest heist that Innocenti uncovered was Hushpuppi's plot to scam an English Premier League soccer team. In the criminal complaint filed by the FBI, Innocenti notes that one of the members of Hushpuppi's team actually sent the name of an English Premier League team and listed the club's address as the stadium where the club plays. Apparently, they had some scheme to scam some unnamed English Premier soccer team of £100 million. Just for reference, the record for the biggest transfer was £105 million. What was the exact plan here? This sounds like this was a scam that may have been something too ambitious. When Hushpuppi finally had his day in court, his lawyer defended him by calling him an entrepreneur who made his money legitimately through selling real estate and promoting brands as an Instagram personality. Supposedly, Hushpuppi was able to support his lifestyle by promoting designer products on Instagram. He posed with high-priced items because that's what he got paid to do. Well, at least that's what his lawyer argued. Hushpuppi did have over 2.5 million followers, but even with that follower account, there's almost no way he'd be able to make the amount of money he looked like he made. Not strictly from promoting big brands. As for selling real estate, no one can find any transactions. Plus, he got famous because of what he posted on Instagram. He wasn't famous for anything else. How did he get the money in the first place? We're gonna say this case probably won't go well for Hushpuppi. What do you think? Find out just how Nuke Bizzle should have done it if he decided to scam the government. First of all, what is an EDD check? EDD stands for Employment Development Department. An EDD check or a debit card is unemployment cash for people who've lost their job. This specific EDD scam was done in California where Nuke Bizzle lived. How easy was it for this guy to get $1.2 million worth of EDD money? What was he supposed to do if he didn't want to get caught? Now, who is Nuke Bizzle anyways? His real name is Fontrell Antonio Baines, and he's a rapper who was originally from Memphis, Tennessee, but he's moved to the Hollywood Hills in LA either because of his rap career or, okay, let's face it, it's because he stole over $1 million from the government. From our digging around on the internet about Nuke Bizzle, it just seems like he's another rapper who hasn't hit it big yet. He has 4 posts on his Instagram account, and one of them is him dancing around with stacks of cash. If you scroll through the comments, you can see that most people are onto his little unemployment check scheme. A lot of the comments are just about the EDD money. It doesn't seem like he cares that many people know that he got his money through a giant scam off the government. And if there's anything we can learn from criminals, it's to not post anything about crimes on social media, because a lot of times they just get caught. But you know what? This guy decided to take it even further and made a rap video and posted it on YouTube about his crime. In this video called EDD, him and his boy Fat Wizza are just literally rapping about scamming the government. They rap about getting rich off EDD checks as if nothing could go wrong for them. The most hilarious part has to be the fact that he started making free Nuke Bizzle merchandise ever since he got arrested. He posted the link on the page ever since his video started taking off. We definitely can't fault that entrepreneurial spirit. However, Nuke Bizzle isn't the only one taking in all the free publicity. If you check out Fat Wizza's Instagram, he's already released a single called Free Nuke Bizzle. Now, it's true, rappers do rap about a lot of illegal things. However, there isn't usually a paper trail. Obviously, they shouldn't have made a rap video describing how they did a federal crime. The problem for Nuke Bizzle was that someone from the government watched his YouTube video, and the government started an investigation as well. It also didn't help that Nuke Bizzle that the government had been on the lookout for fraud. Why? Because as unemployment has skyrocketed in 2020, so have fraudulent claims for unemployment. For example, in September 2020, Arizona had flagged roughly 1 million out of 2.4 million unemployment claims as fraud. That's more than 40%. To run an EDD scam more than once, a lot of different identities are needed. And there also needs to be places to mail the checks or the debit cards. And getting hands on the cash means creating fake identities with fake bank accounts. And that's exactly what Nuke Bizzle did.
According to the feds, he created multiple fake identities to do his scam to get unemployment cash that was intended for people laid off because of the pandemic. Somehow, he was able to get debit cards issued in the names of other people. A lot of the identities were just stolen identities from the internet. He then had the debit cards mailed to places where Nuke Bizzle and his team of scammers had access to it in different places in Los Angeles. Feds found that at least 92 debit cards that had been preloaded with more than $1.2 million were mailed to these addresses. Nuke Bizzle and his scammers allegedly withdrew more than 700 grand cash from the cards. Las Vegas detectives actually found a live stream video on Nuke Bizzle's Instagram account that showed people withdrawing cash from several ATMs with the EDD song playing in the background. But where exactly did Nuke Bizzle and his team mess up? Was it the rap video? Or was it having someone's actual name used on an address? How exactly did they all get the stolen identities? The way we see it, if they decided to do a crime, they should have just done the crime all the way. It wasn't making the rap video that was the really dumb part. That was only pretty dumb. The really dumb part is using real names for any part of the crime. They shouldn't have used anything with their legal names on it. That way, the police can't trace any part of the scam to them. And especially don't carry around any of the debit cards with the stolen identities printed on them. But of course, if this guy was dumb enough to make a rap video about his crimes, he wasn't smart enough to not use his real name somewhere. 74 of the EDD claims were mailed to just one single specific address. The property at that address was a rental property that offered short-term leases. Nuke Bizzle rented that property in his legal name. He was staying there between June and August 2020. He even returned to the property after he moved out just to collect the checks. The fact that he used his legal name made it really easy for investigators to figure out who was behind the scam. What was the smart play for Nuke Bizzle? If he had actually used a fake ID to stay at the place, the police would have had a much harder time catching him. Because even if Las Vegas police recognize Baines as Nuke Bizzle on the street, they can't just search him for EDD debit cards just because of a rap video. The rap video didn't help because it's what alerted the feds. They might have not gotten caught if they didn't make a video about it on YouTube. And the police identity would have had a tougher time catching them if he had used fake identities for everything. Picture this scenario. Let's say he had used a fake ID to rent that one property where he sent the EDD checks to. Investigators would be looking for the person whose identity was stolen. All Baines had to do was just not carry any of the fake IDs and walk around with his real IDs. The police wouldn't have been able to connect him to the scams if they stopped him for whatever reason. That would have been the smart play. Actually, the smartest play is to not do any crime at all. The smarter play would have been to do what these smart rappers did. Find out more here. In order to arrest Nuke Bizzle, all the police had to do was figure out his real name, which they did, and then match him up with his real ID in real life when they found him, which they did. The rap video was what put Nuke Bizzle on the radar with the feds. He was arrested just 12 short days later after the video was released on YouTube. On September 23rd, 2020, Las Vegas police arrested Fontrell Antonio Baines, aka Nuke Bizzle. When he was arrested, police found 8 EDD debit cards, 7 of which were in the names of other people. If he's found guilty of his charges, he's looking at 22 years in prison.
Here are some of the most ridiculous pastors around the world. Number 9, Kenneth Copeland. Prosperity pastors are some of the most popular TV preachers in the country. They pack their mega churches each week and take in millions every year. They urge their faithful followers to donate generously, and in return, the Lord will bring them prosperity. Well, there's no denying some people have prospered handsomely. The pastors themselves. They live like rock stars with huge mansions, private jets, and fancy cars. Their lifestyles are so lavish, some of them have been investigated by the U.S. Senate. One of them is the prosperity preacher Kenneth Copeland, who's been preaching for over 40 years. And after 40 years of preaching to thousands of people who donate to the church, he's able to afford his lifestyle. Copeland lives in a $6 million, 18,000 square foot home on the outskirts of Fort Worth, Texas. The home comes equipped with water views and a boathouse too. And because Copeland is an avid pilot, and he also owns a Cessna Citation jet, it's the fastest private jet money can buy. He said he needed it to better serve the Lord, and he actually proudly did a flyby for his followers after the church bought it.
But that's not the only plane used by his church, as there's actually a fleet of planes registered to the church. And you won't catch him waiting in line at the airport, because he's got his own. The Kenneth Copeland Airport is located right next to his mansion. He famously got angry during an interview when an Inside Edition reporter asked him why he needed to fly private instead of commercial and why he needed different private jets. He's actually said before that he didn't want to fly, quote, in a long tube with a bunch of demons. And he also claimed that Tyler Perry was selling his private jet for so cheap, he couldn't help but buy it. Number 8. Creflo Dollar. Creflo Dollar is the senior pastor and founder of the famous World Changers non-denominational church headquartered in Fulton, Georgia. His ministry was first started at a cafeteria in 1986 with only 8 people. In that meeting, Creflo raised $100 from the people that showed up. Fast forward to 2007, and the cash flow received in his church for that year was around $70 million. His congregation had grown to over 30,000 active members by then. His church auditorium, named the World Dome, was built and paid with $18 million in cash. With all that money coming into the church, Dollar doesn't lead a simple lifestyle. He loves his material possessions, and he has the same message to parishioners that God does not want you to be poor. Dollar's church centers around the controversial teachings of prosperity theology. Dollar was also under investigation, just like Kenneth Copeland, for using his church as a tax shelter to fund extravagant lifestyles. The government really needs an audit to figure that out. Dollar owns Rolls Royces, a private jet, and high-end real estate. When he was asked to explain his private jet, he said, quote, "In order for me to do what I have been called to do, the airlines, they don't fly my schedule." Number 7. Joel and Victoria Osteen. Joel Osteen is known for his big smile and positive preaching. And, oh yeah, having a ton of money. Since becoming the head of Houston's Lakewood Church, Osteen has grown the church's membership to more than 40,000 people. But it's not his preaching alone that's responsible for his fame. Joel Osteen is also a best-selling author and popular motivational speaker together with his wife, Victoria. Osteen met his wife at a jewelry store, and their first date was at the church where they now both preach. In 2017, his reported net worth was somewhere between $40 to $60 million. As a senior pastor, Osteen says he draws no salary from the church, which has an annual budget of $70 million. Instead, he says he fully relies on income from his book sales. The Osteens live in a $10.5 million home that has 6 bedrooms, 6 bathrooms, 3 elevators, 5 fireplaces, a guest house, and a pool house. Of course, he also owns Ferraris and Rolls Royces. Osteen is another prosperity preacher who claims that people shouldn't feel guilty for possessing lots of material wealth. Instead, all a person needs to do is thank and praise God for the acquired wealth. Number 6. Ed Young. Pastor Ed Young is famous for his quote, "God gave me a Ferrari because I am a Ferrari." He said this right after he literally drove up to the pulpit in a Ferrari. Someone gave him a Ferrari, he decided to drive it up onto the church stage. He also went viral after he tweeted that he got the Ferrari as a gift. Apparently, Young was using the Ferrari as part of a sermon illustration for his series titled RPM, Relationships, Passion, Marriage. He's also been seen behind the wheel of a Rolls Royce, which also was used as a prop when he went on stage for another sermon. The Rolls Royce was used as a way of telling the congregation that they're a Rolls Royce because they're made in the image of God. Young is trying to relay the message that God has given everyone a Rolls Royce or a Ferrari, and that many people aren't driving their cars correctly. According to him, many people are cars that are driving off the road. Doesn't it seem like it's just an excuse for him to drive fancy cars? How do you feel about pastors and exotic cars? Let us know in the comments. Number 5. William H. Curtis. Pastor Dr. William H. Curtis is another pastor who's well known for his luxurious taste in cars. Curtis parked his Bentley Bentayga at his church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and it caught the attention of a parishioner who accused him of scamming the community. A photo of Curtis's black Bentley was uploaded to Facebook with the caption, "If your pastor is driving a Bentley truck, he's sucking your community dry with hope
in tithes. How does owning a Bentley that cost over 200 grand contribute to the community in any way? And also to what a pastor preaches is something that many people have asked. The Bentley SUV costs nearly twice as much as the median home in the church's neighborhood of Larimer, one of the poorest neighborhoods in Pittsburgh. Number 4. Vyacheslav Baskakov. Russian Orthodox priest Vyacheslav Baskakov has been called out for his Instagram posts flaunting extravagant items from Gucci and Louis Vuitton. Is it actually wrong for a priest to be into fashion? No, but not when it's just for showing off. He posted pics on his Instagram that showed off luxury items such as Gucci slippers and loafers, as well as Louis Vuitton handbags and luggage worth thousands of dollars. He deleted the photos after they began to draw attention. I mean, what was he expecting? Isn't posting on Instagram essentially saying, look at me? Church leaders obviously were angry at Baskakov for his poor taste, and a disciplinary committee was brought together to, quote, bring him back to real life. Baskakov apologized for his photograph, saying he would suffer penance and shut down his Instagram account since he's not able to behave humbly and appropriately. He denied owning the items from Gucci and Louis Vuitton, saying he had taken most of the photographs in stores. He said that he would sew expensive-looking buckles onto his shoes to make them look, quote, festive. The spokesman for the Russian Orthodox Patriarch Kirill said that hopefully this will bring this shepherd to account. But the Kirill himself suffered a similar scandal in 2012 after he was caught in a meeting wearing a watch worth an estimated $30,000. Number 3. Alf Lukau. Alf Lukau is an extremely popular pastor in South Africa. He has a big following because, according to some of his parishioners, he has the ability to heal any kind of illness. That, and he's able to resurrect people while having a lifestyle like a rapper. Lukau is known for his extravagant lifestyle with cars ranging from Bentleys to Rolls Royces. Lukau started his ministry in February of 2002 in Johannesburg, South Africa. Alf Lukau is the general overseer of Alleluia Ministries International, and he's supposedly worth $1 billion. This is the same guy who preaches to his parishioners to tithe at least 10%, no matter the income level. Before he arrives for church, police officers lead a convoy on a traffic-free road. Thousands of people are lined up on the street waiting to hear Lukau speak. Lukau goes to church in a presidential-style convoy. He'll show up from inside a Rolls Royce with another 10 cars riding behind. Number 2. Joyce Meyer. Joyce Meyer is a TV preacher and president of Joyce Meyer Ministries. She leads an opulent lifestyle filled with fancy homes and expensive cars. Meyer is another person who preaches prosperity gospel. She tells her audience that if they give to her ministry, God will bless them with their own financial rewards. Back in 2003, the St. Louis Dispatch newspaper piece detailed Meyer's luxurious lifestyle. At that time, the ministry pulled in $8 million a month, but spent only a tenth of that on charitable works. The rest of the money was used in some interesting ways. The paper found that Meyer's $20 million headquarters has the look and feel of a luxury resort hotel. Local tax officials, in an unsuccessful attempt to get the building on the tax roll, conducted an inventory of the building's contents. The tax assessor's report found that the building contains artwork, furniture, glassware, and equipment worth $5.7 million. This includes a $23,000 toilet. Since 1999, the ministry has bought 5 homes for Meyer and her 4 children. The collective value of the homes is at least $4 million. Meyer and her husband live in a 10,000 square foot Cape Cod style home with a garage that can hold 8 cars. The ministry pays for upkeep on all of the houses. Meyer called the homes a good investment for the ministry and said that the ministry bears the cost of upkeep and maintenance because the family is too busy to take care of such tasks. Number 1. Miriam Mbula and Toby Adeboyega. Does a church that encourages you to take out loans just so you can donate money to them sound like a scam? Yeah, it probably is. Pastors Miriam Mbula and Toby Adeboyega both drive cars that are well over 6 figures. Toby has a Lamborghini with the personalized plate Pastor, while Miriam has a Rolls Royce. They both had allegations from dozens of ex-worshippers who claimed that they were forced to take out bank loans and donate thousands of pounds to fund the church's lavish spending. They tell their church members through video messages that they need to raise hundreds of pounds a week, a process known as sowing seed.
Former members claim that they've racked up thousands in debt because of the church's demands. They claim that the pastors helped them fill out applications with fake details just so they can get a loan. Apparently, they even went as far as helping members set up a company just so they could get a business bank account with access to an even bigger loan. Here are some of the best robberies ever done. Just wait until you find out how one crime was solved because of a sandwich left behind. Number 12, Banco Central. This robbery at Banco Central remains the biggest bank heist in Brazil. Allegedly, it involved at least 25 people who planned it out intensely for 3 months. And in 3 months, they came up with one of the most ingenious operations. They rented a building near the bank, posing as a landscaping company. That way, it didn't tip off the neighbors when they saw trucks carrying dirt and other sorts of debris every day from the building. However, the debris was actually coming from a tunnel that the group was digging that led right to Banco Central's vault. On August 6, 2005, the group finally hit the jackpot. As usual, they transported the $71 million hard cash in their trucks like they would with the debris they dug. And since it was a weekend, this mega heist wasn't discovered until Monday. To this day, much of the cash remains unaccounted for. Just a few of the gang members were ever arrested. Number 11, Dunbar Armored Facility. The Dunbar Armored Robbery remains the largest cash robbery in the US. The amount stolen in 1997 was close to $19 million in cash. But adjusted for inflation, it's slightly over $30 million in 2020. The heist is also notable since anyone that participated in the robbery were all caught, all thanks to one of them being too reckless with the cash. Much of the heist's success can be pinned on Dunbar Armored's employee, Alan Pace. Pace took the time to write down every security detail of the premises, and he shared it with his accomplices. Coincidentally, he actually got fired just a day before the robbery after he was caught messing around with the vehicles. When they decided to do the robbery, they knew exactly what to do and where to go. Pace knew exactly the right bags to pick, which are the bags with the highest denominations and non-sequential bills. The entire operation was over in just roughly half an hour. They made a clean escape, and it seemed like they'd completely get away. They laundered the cash through various things such as new homes, cars, and even a Texas business venture. But their freedom and newfound fortune were immediately cut short just 2 years later. One of the robbers stupidly gave out a stack of cash to his real estate broker with the original currency bands on the cash, raising suspicions. Number 10, Carlton Cans. In 2013, a number of French cities were hit with a whole bunch of jewelry heists. The Carlton Hotel exhibition was one of them, and by far the largest. It also happened right under everyone's noses in broad daylight. The daring thief turned up with his face covered with a hat and a scarf, all the while holding a pistol at guests and exhibitors at a private hair salon. The jewels were simply put on display by Israeli billionaire Leviev. Interestingly, none of the guards at the exhibit were armed, so the robber peacefully made away with his loot that was estimated to be worth $136 million. To this day, not much progress has been made in their recovery, at least not in the public eye. No one knows who the lone gunman was and where he took the jewels. A $1.3 million reward was offered for anyone with information about the stolen jewels, but nothing has turned up yet. There were speculations that the heist might have been orchestrated by a high-profile member of the Pink Panthers, Milan Popovic, who had just escaped from a jail a few days prior. Number 9, Northern Bank. Carried out just days before Christmas in 2004, this robbery is among the biggest so far in British history. Instead of using their smarts, these thieves went for the good old-fashioned method of intimidation to get what they wanted. Posing as Northern Ireland police officers, the robbers abducted two Northern Bank officials and their families a day before the big robbery. The gang kept the two families hostage but released the family members that were bank officials. They ordered the two to go to work as usual the next day. On the day of the robbery, the two bank officials remained at the bank premises after hours and let in members of the gang. From that point on, it was early Christmas for the robbers. They gained access to the bank's cash storage room. This room had a much larger amount of cash ready for ATMs in preparation for the festivities. For the robbers, it was just a matter of transporting the cash to a nearby waiting van. As soon as they got the cash, the gang released the abducted family members of the bank employees. Not a single one of the thieves have ever been convicted for the robbery.
Number 8. Hatton Garden Safe Deposit. The April 2015 burglary of the Hatton Garden Safe Deposit in London was widely speculated as the largest in British history. The loss quoted in court was £14 million, but some media sources quoted it to be well over £200 million. A major part of this operation was all about drilling through walls and vaults. First, to access the premises, the gang drilled through a wall and then another wall that took them to the building's elevator shaft. From the elevator shaft, they traveled down to the building's basement using ropes. Once they were in the basement, they grabbed the drill again, this time drilling through the vault to where the jewelry was. Aside from the jewels, the gang managed to make away with millions in cash and gems by going through a total of 73 deposit boxes. The recovery has been tough, as just £4.5 million of the stolen assets have been recovered as of 2020. Number 7. Knightsbridge Security Deposit. Pulling off a heist worth close to $100 million requires meticulous planning. But for the 1987 Knightsbridge Security Deposit robbery in London, this wasn't the case. Considering it's one of the biggest bank robberies in history, the theft was executed quite casually. On that day, the two main suspects entered the bank as any other customer would. They requested to open an account for a safe deposit box, and that's when their plan kicked in. Once they were into the vault, they drew their guns and held the bank's occupants hostage. Immediately, they put a close sign on the bank's door while letting in other heist members to assist with the operation. The gang managed to open a majority of the safe deposit boxes and made away with close to $98 million in cash and other valuable items. However, a fingerprint discovered at the bank led the police to Valerio Vici, already notorious bank robber before this robbery. Several of his accomplices were arrested, but he escaped to Latin America to enjoy the loot. He was later arrested, though, when he went back to England just so he could ship a Ferrari Testarossa he left behind. Was that worth the 22 years in prison he got? Number 6. Antwerp Diamonds. The Antwerp Diamond Heist is one of the most popular and largest jewelry robberies ever. It's been called the heist of the century at that time, but bigger jewelry robberies have happened since. It remains one of the most famous diamond heists to date because of how it was stolen with an advanced security system. The vault housing the jewels was protected by infrared heat detectors, a magnetic field, a seismic sensor, and a high-tech combination lock. That's it? Oh no, there's more. On top of all this, there were 18-inch steel doors to get through. Maybe the owner watched too many Ocean's 11 movies? However, on Valentine's Day of 2003, a gang led by Leonardo Notarbartolo breached this high-tech security system in Belgium's Diamond District. They had a $100 million payday in diamonds and other precious jewels. In addition to getting through such an advanced security system, they also had enough time to change the security tapes to avoid being identified. Despite all that, guess how they got caught? They left behind a half-eaten sandwich. That was more than enough DNA for investigators to use. After months of chasing across multiple countries, the group of five was arrested. The jewels, however, were never recovered. Number 5. Dar es Salaam's Investment Bank. The Dar es Salaam bank robbery in Baghdad is one of the biggest ever, but so little is known about the theft. With over $280 million in US cash gone, the heist hardly received any news coverage. Local police authorities couldn't even seem to agree on what really happened. The morning after the robbery, employees of the bank came to work simply only to find the doors unlocked and the vault wide open with the money completely gone. Guards that normally slept at the bank had also disappeared. The local police claimed the heist was orchestrated by the two guards. The interior of the ministry, on the other hand, insisted that the cash was stolen by at least three people. None of the stolen cash has ever been recovered. Also, none of the people involved have ever been found or arrested. Number 4. Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. If you had over $500 million worth of art, you'd have really good security, wouldn't you? Apparently, the security situation at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Boston, the security was extremely lacking for the amount of value inside the museum. The security measures were at least on par to that of regular museums, but improvements were needed for a museum with so many valuable collectibles. Somehow, the museum couldn't afford the improved measures, and making major renovations to the museum was against the late owner of the art's works, Isabella Stewart Gardner's wishes.
1990, during St. Patrick's Day, two thieves disguised as police officers stole 13 priceless art pieces from the museum. The heist was so clean that the thieves left no evidence whatsoever. The museum has offered as much as $10 million for information that leads to the recovery of the paintings. The theft is unsolved to this day, and the frames where the paintings once hang remain empty as an homage to the missing pieces. Number 3. Securitas Depot. This heist remains the biggest known cash robbery in British history. In the world, it's dwarfed by only two other cash heists. In total, a little over £53 million were stolen back in February of 2006. The cash could have been much more, but the robbers actually ran out of time and space to carry away all the cash. According to reports, they had to abandon over £150 million. Here's an interesting fact. This robbery was masterminded by ex-UFC fighter Lee Murray. So how'd they do it? Two of the thieves dressed as police officers, they abducted the manager and his family before taking them to the cash depot. Here, they tied up the staff members and forced the manager to open cash cages. The whole operation took slightly over an hour with none of the hostages harmed. Now, too bad for the robbers, most of them were caught, with the first arrest coming just a few days after the robbery. A considerable part of the loot has also been recovered over the years. Number 2. Berliner Volksbank. Not much is known about this 2013 heist or the people that did it. Even the $10 million lost is just an estimate. However, how the robbers accessed the bank is known. They dug a 120-foot tunnel into the bank's vault from a nearby garage they had rented. After reaching the wall of the bank vault, they drilled a huge hole to the bank's steel wall. They opened close to 100 safety deposit boxes, stealing millions of dollars in cash and other valuables. Their tunnel was discovered after they set it on fire. This was done apparently to destroy any DNA evidence. Very little is known of who did it or what happened to the thieves. Number 1. Central Bank of Iraq. While most heists depend on smarts and a bit of violence, the Central Bank of Iraq was different. It was more of a withdrawal ordered by the highest authority in the country back then. Yep, Saddam Hussein. This was a few hours before the US invasion of Iraq. Saddam was probably sensing defeat even before the operation, so he gave his son a signed note. On it was an order for the bank to give his son a little over $1 billion worth of cash total. 900 million in US dollars and 100 million in euros. And the bank did just that. For close to 5 hours, Saddam's son, along with other unnamed individuals, transported the staggering amount of US dollars to an unknown location in vehicles. According to the New York Times, at least $650 million of the stash was recovered in one of Saddam's former palaces. Not much is known about the remaining amount. Garrison Courtney was again recruiting for his secret task force. In 2014, he approached dozens of companies with a pitch, the chance to join a secret government program. He told them that the program was so secret, the knowledge of the existence of the program could cost some agents' lives. But it was worth it because it's a program that would save way more lives. He called this top secret enterprise Alpha 214. It was approved exclusively by President Obama. Their secret activities were routinely discussed in surveillance-proof sensitive compartmented information facilities, or SCIFs for short. All around the DC area are companies just looking to get big national security contracts, and this was their chance. Just how did Garrison Courtney do it? Before we get into his scams, let's take a look at how it all began. Garrison Kenneth Courtney was a military brat. He was born in the Philippines when his dad was stationed there with the Air Force, so he's been around the military his entire life. During his time in high school, it looked like he had a lot of potential. For example, he was on the debate team and he was a member of the drama club, hint hint. His communication and persuasion skills also made him class president of his class. One of his high school teachers described him as someone who loved the spotlight. According to her, Garrison was the type of person who had plenty of schemes in his head. She went on to describe Garrison as a manipulative person who would cook up ways to persuade the students around him into doing what he wants. So it's safe to say that Garrison already had all it takes to be an excellent con man right from his younger days. After college, Garrison worked a few legit jobs before he ventured into a life of crime. He worked as a weatherman on CBS. He even worked at TMZ for a while. He then started getting into government jobs. He went to work as a public affairs officer for U.S. Immigration. He then took a job as a communications staffer for U.S. House Representative Catherine Harris. In 2005, he took on the role of public affairs officer for the DEA. It was through these government positions where he was able to start making the connections he needed to start his scheme. During his years in service as a government employee, Courtney gathered intel on how the government operated, and his positions gave him access to sensitive information. Garrison Courtney designed and began something many people in the government have called the greatest scam. What was his pitch? He told companies and government officials that he was a CIA agent who worked in a secret program. His pitch was simple to the companies: put me and my security guy on your payroll so we can look like ordinary citizens while we're operating undercover, and we'll reward your loyalty with big contracts for your company. And the best part? The monthly salary they'd get, the companies would be reimbursed. What's there to lose? Garrison came up with program names such as Alpha 214 and FirstNet. He was extremely meticulous and bold with his scheme that it was almost too ridiculous to not be true. He would really play up his part of someone who served. He told companies that he was a Gulf War veteran. He would tell stories about how he could vividly recall choking in the thick black smoke of Iraq's oil fields, and that was why he had breathing problems. Except his breathing problem was simply that he just had asthma. He also said he had survived assassination by a foreign intelligence agent who tried to poison him with ricin. He went to extraordinary lengths to prove that he was a supposed top secret agent. He created fake government non-disclosure agreements, letters that were supposedly from the Attorney General of the United States. The letter was supposed to grant immunity to Garrison and anyone who helped in this fictitious CIA operation. Told company officials that they were under strict surveillance by hostile foreign intelligence services. He even went as far as searching them for electronic devices to show his counterintelligence methods. He demanded anyone he met to meet in sensitive, compartmented information facilities to create an illusion that they were involved in a highly classified intelligence operation. For example, Norman Hayes, a retired Navy Rear Admiral and 30-year veteran of intelligence work, was fooled by Garrison himself. According to Norman, Garrison knew the jargon and he had connections everywhere in the government. If he needed access to a government facility that can't even be revealed in public, somehow he'd get access. To him, there is no way Garrison was not part of an actual secret government operation. Garrison was able to scam $11 million from just one company alone. He scammed over a dozen companies. Garrison had plenty of pawns who didn't know they were in on a scam. He convinced several real government officials that they had been selected to join the program. The recruitment of Norman Hayes, whom we just talked about, is a great example of someone who was in the know, but still was used as a pawn in Garrison's plot. Garrison simply met Hayes and went to him with a proposal. He wanted Admiral Hayes to join an association of IT companies that he was assembling to go after big government contracts. They needed his intelligence experience to help a collection of small companies so they could compete with the big firms. Everything seemed normal to Hayes at first, but after a few normal meetings, everything changed. The meetings moved to secure buildings and phones were confiscated and non-disclosure agreements signed. With representatives from several Beltway companies in the room, Garrison revealed that he was a government intelligence officer working undercover and he needed Hayes for something much bigger. Garrison was smart enough to use the legitimacy of both the corporate and military sides to give him credibility for his scam. For the corporate companies, the presence at meetings of even just one single distinguished admiral with a high-flying career in intelligence operations bolstered the credibility of the scheme. For the military officials, having all the companies in on the scheme was enough. That, and the supposed objective of counteracting the damage done by whistleblower Edward Snowden. Obviously, Alpha 214 wasn't anything real. What it really was a case study of how companies are greedy for government contracts. These companies are all in the lucrative high-tech national security business that try to get their share of the black budget, which is a collection of classified intelligence programs that total tens of billions of dollars. It's basically a legal treasure hunt for these companies for taxpayer dollars. And plenty of retired government officials are hired by these companies to legally secure these types of contracts.
So many companies believed his pitch because they were hungry for big contracts. The reason why any of this worked is because of the simple fact that stuff like this does happen in the government. Any intensive and determined investigation would reveal none of his ties to the CIA because it's supposed to be that way, even if there actually were no connections at all. Courtney used his acting skills to his advantage. His days in the drama club in high school didn't go to waste. He started telling all sorts of lies to people just to get into their companies. But what about government officials themselves? It's the simple fact of sworn to secrecy. It's full of people who understand that they can't talk about secrets. It's not just the fact that they can't share what they know, they can't even admit to knowing it. So they're quite easily duped if a scammer knows the way and how they speak. Garrison had successfully brainwashed the corporate officials so much that when the FBI and other investigators met with them to ask about him, they simply would refuse to talk. They believed talking to the FBI about Garrison would blow his cover as a CIA agent. The problem for Garrison was how long could he get companies to send him monthly checks for nothing? The contracts have to show up sometime, right? The companies that had him on their payroll started asking when the contracts were going to roll in. By early 2015, there were stirrings of unease in Garrison's amazingly well-run scam. Companies started demanding to get paid. For example, one company, Blue Canopy, was especially vocal. So what did Garrison do? He ran the good old-fashioned rob Peter to pay Paul scheme. In this case, Garrison found an investor named Matthew Milstead. Garrison told him that the government was about to seize Blue Canopy, but there was a loophole where an outstanding bill needed to be paid, or else the company can fend off the seizure by the government. And within this loophole, the government can't write the check themselves. If Milstead would pay the roughly $1.9 million owed to Blue Canopy, his investment firm would receive a federal contract authorizing a payment of $2.55 million within 30 days. It was a month's profit of about $600,000, and best of all, it was a contract with the US government. Garrison faked all the documents and got a check from Milstead. This was one major crisis averted. So how did Garrison's house of cards finally come down? It was when Garrison approached the head of Air Force Intelligence, Robert Otto. He attempted to recruit him for even more credibility for the growing number of companies recruited. He told General Otto that he was going undercover to different companies to dig up and flush out foreign spies. Otto was skeptical and thought the whole thing sounded weird. So Otto started researching about the supposed operation Garrison spoke about. A few months later, Otto met up with Garrison again. Problem for Garrison, Otto was wired for the FBI. The meeting helped unravel Garrison's scheme, and by spring of 2016, he was completely exposed on tape with all his lies. A whopping 10 different intelligence agencies had to work together to bring Garrison Courtney in. It took them over 5 years to finally bring him to justice. In June 2020, Courtney pleaded guilty to his crimes, but did this stop him? No! Even with his pleas, he still found ways to continue his scam. He reached out to one company and told them that he was a legitimate but burned asset disavowed by the CIA. Courtney's lawyer, Stuart Sears, argued that his post-conviction lies were done to cover a friend from being wrongly implicated in his scheme. Do you believe that? Garrison admitted that the lies got out of his control and he had to continue since there was no way out. In the end, Garrison Kenneth Courtney was sentenced to 7 years imprisonment. Maxime Boyko was flying into Miami from Russia to do a rap album earlier this year in January 2020. Everything seemed normal except for the fact that he had $20,000 cash on him. Customs agents were wondering what he was doing with that much money. For Maxim, it was easy to explain where the cash came from. He claimed it was money from rental real estate and Bitcoin investing. Customs agents didn't buy it, but they let him go anyway. But they did report him to the FBI, and they started looking into who he actually was. Maxim also goes by Plinofficial, which is the Russian rap name. We don't need to say that Plinofficial isn't a household rapper in the US, but Plinofficial was voted by MTV viewers in Russia as the 74th best Russian rapper. How much money does the 74th best rapper in Russia make? The source of all the money and wealth Maxim shows on his Instagram was questionable. He had pictures of himself on yachts and in exotic cars showing off cash. Who really was Maxim Boyko and what did he actually do for that money? Maxim Boyko was born in the oil drilling town of Muravlenko in northern Siberia, close to the Arctic Circle. His parents were simple working class people, so he wasn't exactly born poor, but the money he shows wasn't from his parents either. Maxim had always been into hip-hop. He was thoroughly influenced by the lives of rappers he saw on TV. He and his friends really got into the hip-hop culture. For example, they would breakdance at different festivals in nearby towns. The music they were performing was influenced rappers making trap music in the US, and they were quickly making it a thing in their own town and surrounding areas. Except trap music in Russia had its own sound. Maxim and his friends formed a group called Swagga Music. They were actually one of the first groups to perform trap music in Russia before it got really popular. But the person who was the driving force behind their group and the local rap scene passed away. So Maxim didn't have a reason to stay as the local trap scene died down. Maxim had to figure out a way to make money. So he moved to Europe to look for work. Maybe in another universe, Maxim would have been a famous Russian rapper if his friend were still alive. Maxim moved on from the Russian trap scene and headed to Paris to look for jobs. But he ended up in South China as the job hunt in Europe didn't work out. Around March of 2013 was when he first started posting pictures of his cash on his social media pages. And his friends started wondering how he made all his money. He explained on his social media that he made money by being a trading rep for a Chinese company that sold products in Russia. He apparently did do business, but Maxim didn't exactly work for the company. He was actually doing deals on his own. He would use the Chinese company for credibility, but he would find his own clients. Basically, he would find a reliable Chinese supplier for whatever clients he was able to pull in. For example, he supposedly helped the company in Russia find wall plugs. So he would negotiate a price for the wall plugs with the Chinese company and then sell it at a higher price to the Russian company. And Maxim would then charge consultant fees to the client for his help. Maxim was reportedly sharpening his business skills in China. But why did the Chinese company allow him to use their company for credibility? The owners of the company were Russian themselves, so they felt compelled to do Maxim a favor. Maxim was someone from Russia, new in China, trying to make it on his own, just like they were doing once upon a time. Maxim wasn't all about spending money, though. He also sent some money back to his parents. One time, he told his dad to meet a friend to get a package he had sent to him. What was in it? Just roughly 1.5 million rubles in cash. This was roughly the equivalent of $48,000. His parents were astonished with the amount of money he had sent back. Maxim reassured his parents that he made the money in a legit way, but it was still hard for people looking at his social media to believe that he had made that much cash just from helping businesses find Chinese suppliers. 2 years later in 2017, Maxim left China and went back to Russia to go after his true passion. Yep, he wanted to get back into rapping, but he still needed to be able to keep up his lifestyle. He apparently didn't want to keep finding Chinese suppliers for his clients anymore. And this is how he got on the FBI's radar. The FBI first learned of Maxim during the summer of 2017. On the same day he released his debut rap album called Goldie in July of 2017, Greece authorities coincidentally arrested a Russian citizen named Alexander Vinnik. Alexander didn't know Maxim personally. Alexander is widely considered the brains of the crypto exchange that Maxim frequently used, an exchange called BTCE. That exchange was seized because it was found to be a giant money laundering operation for criminal organizations. Maxim's email was found to be on a long list of emails who were big clients for Vinnik's exchange. The name that was associated with Maxim? The name Genghis on that exchange. Maxim was considered a big client because he put in almost $400,000 to buy and withdraw 136 bitcoins from the exchange. FBI at that time were examining who used the exchange, but they still didn't know who were the criminals and who were just crypto whales. It took the FBI almost 3 long years to figure out what Genghis was doing. Maxim was stopped at customs in Miami in 2020, and that incident got Special Agent Samantha Shelnick to lead the investigation that specifically focused into where his money came from. The FBI tracked Maxim's Bitcoin wallet activity and followed the money. They concluded that he was part of a large cyber criminal organization called CAS. This huge money laundering group was involved in cybercrime in up to 16 different countries. So how did they operate? CAS advertised its money laundering services in underground Russian-speaking online criminal forums. They laundered client money by opening several hundred personal and corporate bank accounts with shell companies they had set up. Then they would be able to wire large amounts of money stolen from victims and then have the money flow through different trails. They mostly use corporate bank accounts since those accounts are able to receive big amounts of money without raising the suspicion of bank officials. The strange thing was, CAS members sometimes registered shell companies and opened bank accounts using fake names and fake IDs. And other times they'd be like, nah, we'll use our real names and real IDs. CAS's clientele typically have access to groups of computers loaded with viruses, which are known as botnets. Once someone's computer is infected with malware, then the scammers are able to get the victim's banking credentials. That's when they'd start the wire transfers to CAS bank accounts. The crazy thing is how profitable their business was. CAS received a whopping 40 to 50% of their clients' money. At the time of his arrest, the FBI found out that Maxim conspired to commit money laundering all the way as early as 2015. Maxim's role was to convert the stolen money into different cryptocurrencies. He mainly controlled bank accounts in Hong Kong and the transactions that flowed through. Now, how did Maxim get into this network anyways? It looks like he was just good friends with one of the top guys. One of the biggest clues the US authorities had of Maxim's illegal dealings were what he posted on his social media accounts, particularly his Instagram. No matter how many criminals get caught because of their social media, they still want to show off anyways. It didn't matter how small his audience was, Boyko often posted pictures of his lifestyle. He couldn't help but want to let people know how he was living. Special Agent Samantha Shalnick said pictures from Maxim's Instagram were inconsistent with what a person with a legitimate business would post, and what he was actually doing were exactly the type of activities of what people with stolen money would be doing. The FBI concluded that rental income and legitimate Bitcoin investments could not have possibly generated the cash flow Maxim claimed. Think about it. Even if he did own enough real estate to generate the cash flow, how did he make the cash to buy the buildings themselves? Same with the Bitcoin. And since all the pictures of the stacks of cash were posted to a public site, his Instagram pics are able to be used as solid evidence. Maxim was in the US for only 2 months before the US Attorney's Office in Pittsburgh officially charged him with conspiracy to commit money laundering and put a warrant out for his arrest. Would things have worked out differently if Maxim never posted his pics on Instagram? What about if he didn't bring all that cash over on the plane? Would the police ever start to look into who he was? Would things have turned out any different for him? Amazingly, the timeline of the photographs found on Maxim's Instagram matched the timeline of his money laundering through Chinese accounts. One particular photograph posted on August 25th, 2015 shows a large stack of Chinese yen on a table with a label that reads Maxim and the date. He had been money laundering for people probably the entire time he was in China. How this lottery lawyer scammed his clients. Jason Kurland was arrested on August 18, 2020 with three of his partners. Why? Well, because they had been ripping off lottery winners all across the US for millions of dollars under the guise of offering legal and investment advice. Jason Kurland was famously known as the lottery lawyer. He spent years carefully branding himself as the go-to guy for lottery winners. In his own words, he was there to help, quote, to secure their wealth for generations. He had a very simple pitch. He promised to help big winners navigate the lottery system and protect them from predators coming for their cash. But instead, he was the giant predator they needed protecting from. What he did was charge winners tens of thousands of dollars in fees for very little work. Then, somewhere along the line, the mob got involved. He and the mobsters stole a lot more money from the lottery winners. In total, Kurland, along with his mob associates, are alleged to have scammed lottery winners out of $107 million. How did this self-proclaimed savior of lottery winners turn out to be such a huge scammer? Kurland graduated back in 2001 from law school at Hofstra University, meaning he's been a lawyer for almost two decades. He had been a partner at Rivkin Radler Law Firm, but the key word is had. His partners have severed ties with him since the fraud charges came out. Representatives for his old firm
talked to the press.
They, not surprisingly, said that they had no knowledge of what was going on, and the news came as a complete surprise to them. At Rivkin Radler, Curlin dealt in real estate, zoning, and land use, but those areas were more of side hustles to him by 2020. He also seemed to be a great member of the Long Island community. For example, he would volunteer and give out free legal advice at a charity called Interfaith Nutrition Network. They were a nonprofit focused on providing for homeless people in Long Island. His time as a lawyer didn't go unnoticed, and by 2011, he was featured on the top 40 under 40 list by his local paper. So how did Curlin get around dealing with lottery winners? He actually randomly fell into it. His very first lottery client won a jackpot in Connecticut. That client wasn't sure where to go, and he worked for one of Curlin's clients at the time. So Curlin's client referred the winner to him, and Curlin found out how easy it was to make money off of lottery winners. So for nearly a decade, he did as much as he could to make himself the lawyer to call after someone won the lottery. He branded himself the lottery lawyer. He tweeted at any lottery winners he could find, always with the hashtag #callme. He began doing a lot of interviews talking about the lottery. Curlin was constantly called on by the media to offer his insight. This wasn't just about the legal side of wins. They'd ask him about some of the things he would see lottery winners do, such as the big mistakes, how different states handle the wins, and the very first thing lottery winners ought to do. He became the authority on how lottery winners should conduct themselves after suddenly becoming rich. Seeing him on TV endeared him to a lot of lottery winners around the US. It was only a matter of time before one of them sought his services, and he didn't leave that to chance. One of the biggest repeated lines about a mega jackpot win was, "Hire an attorney." And we don't disagree with him here, but you definitely have to be able to hire an attorney you can trust. For Curlin, it was the perfect hook to send any lottery winner running his way. He made it easy to find him with easy to remember, but now defunct website, thelotterylawyer.com. For players, the good news was the big win. For Jason Curlin, it meant a new potential high-paying client. A simple phone call meant that he was getting more money. If someone called, this meant that they were already sold at that point. For Curlin, it was easy. The phone call was all about repeating some of the tips he had given in interviews. Don't tell anybody, sign the back of the ticket, make a copy, and keep it somewhere safe. Once the winners agreed to work with him, Curlin charged an upfront retainer fee that ranged between $75,000 and $200,000. And on top of that, he required a monthly fee that ranged anywhere from $15,000 to $50,000. For what though? What do lottery winners need a lawyer every month for? The rates obviously weren't a problem to the mega winners. After all, they had hundreds of millions of dollars. They just thought that those fees were what were required to help secure the rest of their money. He worked with dozens of winners. The cumulative total in wins for his clients totaled in the billions. For example, just three of his clients who were scammed as part of his scheme collectively won $3 billion. One guy was a guy from South Carolina who won $1.5 billion in the Mega Millions lottery in 2019. While his fees were already high enough, Curlin wasn't just gonna let the billions he had access to slip past him. Initially, he would make traditional investments that got modest returns, that won him the client's trust. And that's exactly when he would start making his moves. Curlin would convince the lottery winners to invest in companies that were owned or controlled by his friends. Christopher Churchio is a reputed soldier in the Genovese crime family. Francesco Russo and Francis Smukler were his supposed underlings. Curlin would get a big kickback whenever clients would invest in the mob-associated businesses. Just to keep the lie going, they funneled money back to the winners and marked them as interest payment. But in reality, there was extremely little going on as far as investments were concerned. Curlin and his mob friends just mostly straight up spent the funds on their lifestyle. They went out blowing the money on luxuries such as exotic vacations, golf club memberships, private jets, and luxury cars. They even went as far as buying two yachts. Churchio paid to be the chauffeur around in a Cadillac Escalade, and he also rented an $11,000 per month apartment in Manhattan. He lived this lifestyle all while claiming to run a plumbing business. That's the irony. Curlin was always vocal about how lottery winners shouldn't be buying all the nicest things. He always insisted on winners laying low for a while to maintain some normalcy. It turns out that he could not take his own advice. When they did actually try to do some business, they weren't exactly great. For example, Churchio invested some of the funds in personal protective equipment because of the pandemic. They had actually made an $800 million deal with an unnamed state. For some reason, that state backed out of the deal. So that left Churchio and his other partners with over $40 million worth of PPE. Russo and Smukler, on the other hand, decided to invest some of the cash with Gregory Altieri, a jewelry merchant. They gave him $250,000 at a sky-high interest rate. According to investigators, they expected Altieri to repay a whopping $400,000. But Altieri couldn't pay up. So what did they do? Obviously, they threatened to get a hold of people close to him, his wife and son. A total of $107 million were alleged to have been mishandled by Kurland and mob associates by the time the authorities got involved. As Kurland and his mob buddies continued with their scamming, the FBI was closing in on them. And they could feel it. They were caught completely on tape discussing how to cover up their scam. And Kurland warned his partners about potentially getting busted because they were way too reckless. But that didn't seem to be much of a bother to Churchio. He honestly didn't care. He was caught on tape rambling on about not being afraid of the FBI, according to phone recordings. To be fair, he might have been genuinely unbothered since he knew a thing or two about getting off the hook. This wasn't his first time brushing shoulders with the law. In 2004, he pleaded guilty to falsifying business records, and in 2019, he was acquitted at trial of bid rigging charges on a construction contract. Churchio's legal battles aside, the phone recordings also exposed Russo's and Smukler's threats against Altieri. But besides the gutsy declarations of violence, Russo and Smukler were open to the idea of getting charged with fraud. Smukler, in particular, hoped for just a fine instead of jail time. They were also caught on tape, not feeling sorry at all for stealing money from lottery winners. Churchio said on tape, quote, "Remember, you and I didn't hit the lotto for $1.5 billion. On August 18th of 2020, their worries about getting caught by the feds came true. In total, these partners in crime faced 21 charges that could see them serve long sentences. All of them were charged with wire fraud conspiracy, money laundering, and money laundering conspiracy. Kurland, on his part, was also charged with honest services fraud for the loss of his client's funds. Smukler and Russo picked up a few additional charges for their threats against the jewelry business owner and his family. All four of them denied the charges, and all of them, except Russo, are out on bail. Russo was a bit unlucky because of his threats to Altieri. Investigators had also found a gun under his bed that obviously could be very well interpreted as his willingness to carry out any of his threats. Of course, Russo's lawyer defended his client, saying the threats were not to be taken seriously. He said that Russo was simply trying to get back their cash in desperation. So far, 13 bank accounts connected to Kurland, Churchio, Russo, and Smukler have been seized. The government has also placed liens on three properties under Smukler's and Russo's names, allegedly purchased and renovated with the stolen funds. For the winners, this is great news for the time being. At least there's a chance for them to get back some of their millions. In many of his media appearances, Kurland always had a lot to say about lottery winners getting scammed. According to him, many of the lucky players weren't sophisticated to spot the scams. But the real question is, how long was he ripping off his lottery clients? From the very beginning, or was it somewhere in between? The feds were only able to uncover roughly a year worth of fraud. He was already making a lot of money. Why did he ultimately start ripping off his clients? Was he somehow already deep in mob connections before? It's sad that Kurland ultimately was part of the scam world he preached against so much. The reason why Chinese women take the same photos. When it comes to Instagram, you'd better not believe your eyes. Well, it looks like the last word in luxury might just be a carefully airbrushed illusion masterfully delivered through trickery, shared resources, and cold, calculating strategy. Nobody in the world does this better than the husband-hunting social climbers of China's rich girl WeChat groups. Why are so many girls taking the same photos with the same poses at the same locations? Are these girls really actually rich? In China, as well as other parts of the world, cons are specifically targeted at celebrities. Celebrities sometimes carry on full relationships with people who aren't what they seem. With how easily it is to connect with celebrities on different social media platforms, they're more vulnerable now than ever. For Chinese women who want to live the luxe life, Snagging a rich husband or celebrity is the easiest way to upgrade their life. It allows them to live in the lap of luxury. For many girls, playing elaborate tricks is simply the price of getting their Prince Charming. And he doesn't understand the scope of the game until he puts a ring on it. For 500 yen, or less than 100 US dollars, aspiring socialites can join super secret WeChat groups that act as training grounds for getting a husband with deep pockets. The groups go by names such as Shanghai Female Socialite and Young Fashion Money. The girls in these WeChat groups don't mince any words about their end goal. It's the dark side of the fake it till you make it crowd. These groups are essentially rich husband training camps. They help girls through the proper steps needed to score a celebrity or rich husband. Since celebrities' lives are fully public, people can easily target them with lonely heart schemes or hard luck stories. The first step to look rich is to manufacture the right look for a rich girl. The plastic surgery-fueled influencer look is a booming industry with Chinese millennials and Chinese Gen Z. It's a huge industry estimated to be around 200 billion renminbi industry for 2020, or roughly 30.6 billion US dollars. Forecasts see a 50% growth in the industry to 47.7 billion US dollars by 2023. And of course, the vast majority who go under the knife are women. The influencer look is simple: large eyes, prominent nose, narrow jawline, and flawless wrinkle-free skin. Across China, the luminous, smiling influencers look almost exactly the same. The internet celebrity face is the uniform the girls need to start their journey to Instagram superstardom. Once prospective influencers have the right look, they have to get the pictures to let the world know that they have money. The girls stage Instagram posts stuffed full of glamorous places and luxury products. These things are essential tools to appearing like they're important people online. Obviously, heavy photoshopping is also done on the photos. In May of 2020, two Chinese influencers were caught doctoring photos to appear slimmer and more photogenic. Their throngs of fans felt betrayed and catfished, but this is only the tip of the iceberg. A lot of these girls are a gang of wannabe influencers fixed on perfecting the socialite con. While it might seem harmless to fake a jet-set lifestyle, they're actually anything but, because for a lot of these girls, it's to get rich husbands through smoke and mirrors. There are plenty of companies on Taobao, a WeChat e-commerce platform, that unabashedly help people to fake a lifestyle. They sell personalized voiceovers over videos of designer cars, mansions, epic tropical vacations, or big stacks of cash. 6 yen, or roughly $1, is all that someone needs to fake out anyone on their Instagram. The turnaround time is nearly instantaneous, and the industry is booming. Fake socialites have another option at their disposal as well: counterfeit geotagging. You can pretend to have it all, including whirlwind trips to Bali, Dubai, or other luxury places with fake geotags. But not everything can be faked. Sometimes you actually gotta show up. But how can these girls actually afford the expensive hotel rooms in the exotic places along with all the designer handbags? The answer lies in strategic sharing. Strategic sharing is vital, especially if you actually are not rich. Also, the girls do need to look rich on a date and match what any prospective husband has seen on her Instagram. One of the golden rules of the young fashion money crowd is always to rent and never buy. The girls rent just about anything, from luxury cars to on-demand services. They do it just so they can take a few photos to post and also to have the right look to impress the rich target at the same time. The other golden rule is that sharing is caring. The girls that look rich aren't actually rich. It's hard for them to justify spending a small fortune on designer purses and clothes, but becomes much more logical and attainable when they split the bill between many other girls. Chinese social climbers and aspiring Instagram stars oftentimes pool money to fake how much money they have. Take the example of a sophisticated brunch or a high tea at a 5-star hotel. Instead of two people enjoying a high-priced meal, 6 girls chip in to offset the cost. The girls rotate through the pictures. Each girl will get her perfect picture with the spread and the illusion becomes a reality, at least in the mind of the person looking at the picture. Do they all split the food when it comes time to eat too? Stuffing high-end hotel rooms to the gills with girls is another way these girls pull off their scam. For example, 15 to 20 girls will pack Shanghai's ritziest and most expensive hotel rooms. Each girl gets her ideal photo, and they're only out about 30 bucks each. It's a small price to pay to prop up the myth that they're wealthy in hopes that someday they really will be. Luxury cars are another popular item to rent. They make great backdrops for photos and are reasonably cheap if you split the cost between 60 girls. It's a better version of the old Taobao trick, but this time, instead of just a voiceover, you get to pose with a real car. The same goes for designer handbags and stockings. Instead of buying the expensive items, girls will rent and share them. There's somewhat of a strange honor system involved. They're fostered by a shared mission and sense of loyalty. After all, these clubs are relatively secretive and nobody will benefit from being outed as a fraud. Although this is great for the fake rich girls, it puts a massive strain on local businesses. They have to deal with dozens of girls sharing things that were never really meant to be shared. In August of 2020, a controversy erupted in the tabloids. The press revealed that Chinese superstars Wilbur Pan and Aaron Kwok were victims of a socialite con. Their wives were actually top graduates of a husband training camp run by a woman named Amy Ji. Photographs showed each woman sitting at an identical table, wearing the same clothes, and eating the same bowl of fruit. Although Ji's photos were the only recent ones to surface, they're definitely not the only ones. As for duplicate images, as the old saying goes, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. She already knows that the photos got the job done for one girl, so why not have the same pose for another girl? The girls have to know how to pose and smile properly, so Ji had to give them the right instruction. Ji photos almost have their own look. She'll show the girls posing while ice skating, lying in a posh bed, or looking into the camera with identical ceramic smiles. Each photo is almost exactly the right balance between being sexy and approachable. The goal is for the girls to drip with sophistication and that she's not gold digging at all. Unlike the Taobao videos featuring huge stacks of money, Ji's looks actually don't scream wealth. They do whisper it. The whisper is the siren call designed to lure in the rich men who think that they're dating women of a similar social class. These images dupe many men into thinking that their Cinderella is a high-class socialite, only to discover that it was a ruse all along after they put a ring on it. Although some people find deception on Instagram to be funny or frivolous, obviously lives are completely changed here. In fairness, these groups aren't just limited to China. The fake it till you make it crowd is a global phenomenon. These savvy wannabe influencers will employ every trick in the book to boost their image and become the next million-dollar influencer. In the UK, influencers are turning to the allure of designer packaging to fake their wealth. It's known as the empty box phenomenon. Influencers will carry around empty bags and boxes from luxury brands such as Hermes and Prada to give the illusion that they shop there. This type of packaging is fantastic for photo shoots too, where what's in the box could be anyone's guess. Old school Photoshop tricks still do the job. Influencers will Photoshop themselves away in exotic locations and five-star adventures. In a world where perception is reality, these influencers can get hundreds of followers by appearing glamorous, even if they're not. These days, virtually anyone can operate Photoshop and create dreamy backdrops and fake vacation pics. TikTok has its own version of humble bragging known as the Falling Stars Challenge or Flaunt Your Wealth Challenge. In this challenge, social media stars get photographed taking a tumble with the luxury contents of their bags spilling out all around them. Other versions of the Falling Stars Challenge include influencers tumbling off private jets or falling in posh restaurants. Although it's a lot less subtle than the carefully cultivated Instagram photos designed to lure husbands, the Falling Stars Challenge is another branch of the same tree. The Falling Stars Challenge is popular with China's perfectly groomed Instagram elite, as well as Russia's rising Instagram stars, who also made waves for posing on fake jets. In the US, there are specific penthouses dedicated for the Instagrammers to rent out in LA. Then there are the companies that rent out private jets that just stay on the ground so pictures can be taken. Private jets are a goldmine for wannabe influencers who want to look rich. These companies will rent out private jets by the hour for for less than $100. They'll allow up to 9 people to take private photographs. Is your favorite influencer taking private jets everywhere? Maybe, maybe not. Okay, most likely not. Although renting a jet for an afternoon photo shoot might seem harmless, it's still rooted in deceit. While the end goal might not be to snag a rich husband, the trickery and illusion are still there. Is this the main reason why Dan Bilzerian fakes his lifestyle? Find out in this video. The Instagram trend of smoke and mirrors is a global phenomenon that doesn't seem to be going anywhere anytime soon. No doubt, the countless fake rich Chinese women will get more sophisticated in their cons. They'll still do whatever it takes to land a celebrity husband so they can completely change their life. There's no doubt that newer, glossier, sleight of hand will be coming soon in the ever-evolving make-believe place that's called the internet. Here's what's next.